typically open a meeting with an opportunity for public comment on anything that's not on the agenda. Anyone got something else on their mind tonight? Okay. I'd like to explain, we have two agenda items opening at 7 o'clock. That's because we think one will be short and we can take care of it. And then we wanted to be able to start the second agenda item when we get to it. And we can't start ahead of time, we can always start a few minutes. We can start anytime after the public's time. So if that was confusing to anyone, that's what that's about. So to start, I'd like to open the agenda item special permit for a 12.75 kilowatt photovoltaic array at 67 Riverbank Road, Northampton, map ID 25-68. Anyone here to present on that?
So we're here tonight just to apply for a special permit.
Your name?
Christopher Meyerhoff with RGS Energy.
Thank you.
We're here to apply for a special permit for, like you said, a 12.75 kilowatt photovoltaic system at 67 Riverbank Road. I believe that we have a good case with all seven requirements for the special permit. And if you'd like me to go through those points, I can.
I don't want you to take a lot of time on each one, but it'd be nice to hear from you.
Sure. So the first point will we'll be protecting adjoining premises from serious detrimental use. There will really be no impact on the surrounding environment or on the surrounding neighbors. The closest that we're going to get to the property line would be 50 feet from the rear of the property, which I believe would be which would be the closest view shed to the array. So I don't believe that that would have any detrimental effect, nor would it promote any additional runoff than would otherwise occur. Will it minimize and mitigate traffic impacts? You know, in terms of immediate impacts, there will be no on-street parking. We'll park on the premises, and long-term impacts, there will be none. It will be on private property. Promote harmonious relationship of structures and open space. I believe this array kind of goes along with cultural milieu of Northampton, and I don't see how that would have any effect. Also, there is another neighboring property that also has a solar array and hasn't seemed to have any negative impact so far. Protect the general welfare. I think in general, solar has a positive impact on the general welfare. You know, that could be debated, I suppose, but I think in general, that's more or less the consensus. Avoid overloading and mitigate impacts on city resources. The homeowners are going to be creating their own electricity that's going to take demand off of the grid. So I think that's a plus for our argument. Promote city planning objectives. I think this goes hand in hand with the sustainable Northampton open space and transportation plan. Specifically, page 19, objective 2 and 3, facilitate the increased energy efficiency use of renewable energy in public and private buildings and increase utilization of energy from renewable resources. I think we're dead on right there. Meet all zoning requirements. This does qualify as an accessory structure, and ultimately that's why we're here tonight for the special permit. It's just requesting to be granted a special permit for this construction.
Right. I'll start by opening it up for questions from the board.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I know later on in the meeting we're going to talk about a new tree ordinance, and I'm not entirely sure I understand it, but as I understand it, it does come into effect when someone needs to apply for a special permit. So in this case, if trees need to come down so the solar panel can function, is that an issue for this board?
Yeah, so you would, so, and actually that's a good question. I think it was probably a good question to ask what size trees will be coming down just for this
right.
project. So this would be an example where an applicant would come forward an applicant that is required to have a special permit or site plan would have to show how many significant trees, and as it's defined in the proposed language, it's 24 inches and at diameter breast height. So it would be appropriate for you to ask what size trees of that scale and beyond would be coming down, because you would have jurisdiction now, even though the ordinance hasn't been adopted, but you it's been advertised. You could require replacement trees if you all felt as a board that that was appropriate.
And if I may, there are no trees, additional vegetation that will need to come down for this solar array, and certainly none greater than 24 inches or anything more than shrubbery.
It's a Google image.
On the map, on a plan view, and I'm not sure if this is just diagrammatic or if this is truly accurate, it shows like it's plopped right down in the middle of the trees. But
yeah, I'm not exactly sure. I haven't seen that
particular area. So maybe that's not actually the location, you know?
Yeah, no, that is not the location. And if you look on the plan view.
I don't want to be out of order here, but
you are.
Excuse
me,
property owner.
I'm sorry.
Okay. I just wanted to let you know I'm here. I could answer something.
Okay, thank you. We'll work our way through it.
Okay.
So you can see most of the site is open. There is some vegetation here, but I need that.
Any others? Is the neighbor's array also ground mounted, or is it house mounted?
That is a roof mount.
And I know it's not built, so you can't tell me if you can see it from the road, but is it?
Will be visible from 91.
From 91.
That's what you're talking about.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, from
okay.
River Bank Road.
Yep. Any questions for the homeowner?
For someone, well, I'm sorry, maybe you mentioned this and I spaced out, but is it, will it be visible from the street, from Riverbank?
Portions of it probably would be, yeah, and perhaps the homeowner can speak better to that.
You're no doubt familiar with the comparable structure that's erected on the other end of Riverbank Road that's really, really, really visible from the street?
I'm not, sir.
It's like a towering, obtrusive, sort of ugly structure right on, as you're going down Riverbank, it's on the left.
Okay.
You really could hardly miss it.
And this is a solar array that we're talking about?
Yeah.
Or just, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You haven't seen what I'm referring to? To compare,
I've seen a lot of ground-mounted arrays, and I know about how they look like. But yeah.
these will be the one I'm referring to has a very large wooden structure on which the solar panels are sitting.
Okay.
And the wooden structure has its back end facing the street,
mm-hmm.
And
it's Riverside Drive or Riverbank.
Riverside Drive.
Yeah, right.
I'm sorry. Right. Okay.
Y'all know the other.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. Riverside Drive. So this would be different. These would be mounted on the ground.
This would be on the ground. The structure would be, there may be a, inches, so a little over 10 feet.
Okay, all right, fine. Yeah, the one I'm referring to, which first of all is on a different street, is way, way, way taller.
25 feet in there. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really ugly.
And now that you mention it, I think I do know what structure you're talking about, and I would agree with your assessment of that.
Thank you.
Any questions of the homeowner? generally after the presentations and after we have our questioning, we open it up if there's anyone from the public that wants to speak on this. Okay.
Move to close public comment.
I actually never officially opened public comment.
You don't need to because you opened the public hearing?
Hearing, okay.
Did you want to hear from the owner, property owner, about clarification?
I think we didn't have any questions for.
If you need any clarification.
Move we close public hearing? Tess and John seconding. Board discussion, which is among us. It seems straightforward.
Very straightforward and clean, and I mean, that's what we're looking for.
Move to approve it.
Second. Tess, all in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. We were right about the schedule, 10 minutes. I now move to open second agenda item, continuation on hearing on special permit by Sunwood Development Corporation for 12 new 13 total townhouse units and site development at 95 Barrett Street, Northampton, map ID 24B-2. Is there a presentation?
I need to recuse myself.
Okay.
And Devin, just a point of disclosure. I have worked in the past and I'm currently working with one of the presenters. I don't think it precludes me from being objective, but if anybody in the audience disagrees otherwise, if you raise your hand, I can.
I actually think since this is a continuation of the last meeting that you are.
It's a continuation, so I've got to recuse.
Yeah, you are recused.
All right, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Hello, my name is David Bloomberg. I'm the attorney for Sunwood Development, and I'm here to do a very brief introduction to this project for the board, and then I will, of course, hand it over to our design professionals to take you through the design features and details, and also to address in greater detail the ways in which the application for the special permit satisfies the requirements that the board is looking into. This involves a property on Barrett Street that runs between Jackson Street and King Street in Northampton. And the existing site has one single family house on it, and that house is going to be renovated and converted to a single unit condominium, but a freestanding building as is. And then the proposal is to build three additional buildings, each with three condominium units in them, and along with four garages and a recycling area and bike rack and actually there have been maybe a total of eight garages, but I'll let Mr. Darnold go into greater detail there. One of the features of the proposal is a central park area. And I would point out that the required park space for a development in this district under these circumstances for this number of units, which will be a total of 13 units, is to have a minimum of 390 square feet of park space. And the development as designed and proposed provides for 6,500 feet of park space. So there's a premium placed on preserving a communal open area that you'll hear about in greater detail. Of the 13 condominium units, and by the way, we actually as of right could build more than 13 units, but again, we're trying to be sensitive to the density issues. 10 units of those 13 will be 1,200 square feet, which has the benefit of making them more affordable in the marketplace. And also, I think, creates a lower intensity of use in the sense that there will be less occupants, less traffic, presumably less cars associated with smaller units. Sunwood Development is owned by Shaul Perry, who's here tonight, and he has been in the business of housing development in the Valley, in Hampshire County, for over 25 years. And we also have Mark Darnold from Berkshire Design, who will be presenting, and he also has been working on development work as an engineer for 25 years, and we have Chris Chamberlain as well from Berkshire Design. Some of the other points that I just want to draw attention to as the board evaluates the overall proposal is that the minimum lot area in this district for this project would be 2,500 square feet per unit. Our proposal allots 7,729 square feet per unit. The minimum frontage required is 50 feet. Ours provides 114 feet. The minimum depth is 75 feet, and our proposal provides 367 feet. The minimum front yard setback required is 10 feet. We are, in our proposal, providing 47 feet of setback. The open space requirement is 40%, and our development with the park space in the middle provides for 63% for the open space. So the and in terms of parking, the requirement is one space per 1,000 square foot of gross living area. We're providing one for 422 square feet of gross living area. So we think that this proposal is a very good project. It's suitable, it's consistent with the overall intentions of the city, and it also falls well within all parameters in terms of the dimensional requirements that would be allowed as of right. Not only does it fall within them, in many cases it is far below the minimum requirements, or far better, in as the case may be. So with that as my introduction, I think I'll hand over the proceedings to Mark Darnold from Berkshire Design. He will walk you through in greater detail the design elements and features and be able to answer any and all technical questions. The one other thing I want to mention is that we have already obtained an order of conditions from the Conservation Commission, and we have already obtained a stormwater management permit from DPW. So to the extent that there are questions about stormwater runoff or inland wetland or buffer protection, we're happy to answer them today. But those details have been reviewed and addressed and approved by the appropriate commission and board with the city with the expertise in those areas. And we already have those approvals in hand. So at least from the city standpoint, I believe those concerns have been addressed. Thanks very much. Mark?
Get the slideshow started.
Order and name for the recorder.
Thank you. I'm Mark Darnold from Berkshire Design, and just want to go over the project very quickly. This is an overall thing, and again, the project is Sunwood Green, and it's located on Barrett Street. I think most people are familiar with the location of the project. And here, sir. Again, this is sort of a blow-up of the project. We'll go back to this. This just gives us an overall picture of the project with the main driveway coming off of Barrett Street, heading north. Since it creates a loop around the project with the appropriate plantings and units. We'll come back, this is our last slide, so we'll come back and talk about it a little more in detail as we get to that point. Again, going through some of the existing conditions, I forgot my laser pen, but you can see the single house which exists there with the driveway coming up to it, the vegetation behind it. We have the next slide which shows the vegetation a little better. Clearer. Now you can see the property outline, relationship to the other houses in the area. And this is an overlay of the project location. As was stated earlier, we're required to have, I think, 30% open space. We have 63% open space. So you can see that there's still a lot of open area along the grass area and the internal portion of the project, which is essentially the cul-de-sac area, we've created a park area, which is a place for the community to get together. There are wetlands to the north of the site, and we respected those northerly wetlands, comply with the wetland bylaws regarding setbacks, protection of the wetlands, and have received an order of conditions to work in this proximity. This is, again, the outline is sort of difficult to see here, with this existing conditions plan, shows existing trees which are existing there. There is a single large tree in the middle of the site which we are proposing to maintain and retain that tree. It's a nice specimen tree, so we sort of cycle the whole project around that existing tree to make sure that it remains and is not harmed as part of this project. It's a little difficult to see, but I could discuss the drainage here, but without seeing the contours, it's a little bit difficult to ascertain. Now, the layout of the project, we essentially have a 20-foot drive entering the project. It's as narrow as we can make it to safely accommodate emergency vehicles. We don't want to make it any wider than we need to for environmental reasons. We don't want to increase runoff. So we have that 20-foot drive going around the entire project. As we get around to the right-hand side, we've narrowed it down to a 14-foot loop road to exit the site. The reason we have that narrow area, we felt we didn't need two-way traffic in that location, but we still needed to be able to get emergency vehicles into the site, around the site, and be able to leave the site. We had a meeting with the fire department and conferred that they would prefer to be able to enter and exit without having to back out on the site, and I think makes the circulation reasonable as well and a safe way to run the project. We do have sidewalks throughout the entire project to encourage pedestrian walkways through the site. They're 5-foot wide concrete sidewalks. The construction standards, as is currently required in the city of Northampton, all the curbs are vertical granite curbs, so we'll have a project that is well built and will last for a long time. We don't have to worry about the shabby construction or something like that. Greenwood, Sunwood Builders always builds well, but with the granite curbs, we know we have a high quality project out there. We have parking space required. We, as I said earlier, we exceed the required parking spaces for the site. We include plantings, patios for the back of the buildings, in the park area. We also have a lot of park planting areas in there with proposed plantings. We have specimen trees proposed in there, a picnic area, a little patio. Shaw Perry has a project similar to this in Amherst, and talking to the residents there, that's sort of the area they like. They'd like to have an open space where they can congregate, a picnic table where they can sit around. So this sort of falls into that area, nicely landscaped area, a place for the local area, the people there to congregate. To describe some of the units, in the very back you'll notice that we do have a garage. Those long rectangular buildings in the back are garages. Trying to get my correct number of garages here. The garages, thought I had the spaces here. The garage is in there for some of the units. Most of the units have parking in the front, but the garages do have parking in them as well. On the far left-hand side of those rectangular buildings, the left-hand portion of that area is a recycle center, so there is no dumpster to be sitting out. The people will come and go inside that last unit on the left-hand side and recycle their trash in that location and be picked up. We do have parking for 37 spaces. Two of them are handicapped spaces. 8 of them are within the garage in the rear, that's what it is. And 3 of the houses have garages as well. They're also on the rectangular buildings and the garages in the back. There's a concrete pad there, and on the side of the building we have the roof overhang there, which will provide for 13 bike racks, so people can have their bikes there, hang them on the wall, keep them out of the weather, have access to them, and a safe place to store them. We have also thought about snow storage. On the upper right-hand corner, you'll see the slightly shaded area. There's an underground detention system there, and that it'll be a lawn area. Because there's an underground detention system there, the ability to put plantings there is limited, so that's an ideal place to put the snow storage. If the snow melts, it goes into the ground, goes into the detention system. So it's an ideal location to store the snow without encumbering the parking areas or the wetlands or the vegetation on the site. I know there's concerns about drainage on the site. We do have, as far as utilities, we have public water to the site, which provides fire protection on the area. We have fire hydrants within the site as well. And we have connection to the city sewer system. So there's no issue regarding the sanitary. The drainage, I know there's been a lot of concern about drainage. The existing site, we did several borings out there, determined that there are poor soil, sandy loams, sort of a clay type material, and fairly high groundwater. There's because of the soils are poorly drained soils and the existing conditions, when we have a rain event, the ground cannot absorb a lot of water, so it does tend to shed a lot of water in the existing conditions. That's a good and bad thing. The bad thing, of course, it generates a lot of runoff. The good thing from a designer's perspective, because there is already a lot of runoff, by developing the site and paving, there's not a drastic increase in runoff due to creating impervious surfaces. But there will be an increase in runoff due to the increased impervious surfaces. And to address that, we are required to ensure that the runoff from the site is no greater than it is in existing conditions. We address that by collecting the water, putting it into an underground storage facility, it's essentially pipes and stone, which holds the water, detains it, and releases at a slower rate. So it doesn't leave the site any more rapid than it does in the existing conditions. Most of the water on the site currently drains from the middle portion of the site towards the north through an existing intermittent stream, which runs from there easterly over to Barrett Street Brook. There is some other areas in the southern portion of the site which drains towards Barrett Street Brook. And the way we address the increased runoff from that location is we took some of the water which typically goes to the south towards Barrett Street Brook or to the east or west, and we've directed that back up towards our detention system. So we decreased the amount of area going that way, which balanced out the amount of water going toward Barrett Street. Therefore, we balance the entire site, so the drainage does not increase from the development of the site. We would make sure that's addressed. It was thoroughly reviewed through the notice of intent process with the Conservation Commission, which also goes to the DEP Wetlands Division for review. We also had to submit this to the DPW under the stormwater permit. They do a thorough review of the drainage calculations and drainage design, and we have been issued a stormwater permit from the city DPW office as well. And I think the next item we have is, this is a planting plan which shows that we have all the brown circles are proposed new plantings. I think we comply with the planting requirements from the city of Northampton. Not only do we comply, I think we made a very nice addition to the site to make sure it's a pleasant place to live and complies with the planting requirements. This is a lighting diagram. It's sort of difficult to see from the site, but each one of those little blob X you see are essentially the lighting that will be discharged from the proposed street lights that we have in there. We do have one small area, which you can show with the, I guess you can't show with the cursor. This area down here in this location, right at Barrett Street, we do show a little bit of light leaving the site. I think the regulations specifically state that that's not allowed to happen unless we get a waiver from the board. Our opinion is that that little bit of light that does spill over the property line, which is essentially the right-of-way onto Barrett Street, is actually a good thing and helps to light up the intersection, and we would respectfully request the board to allow that waiver for the small spillage of light over onto Barrett Street right at the intersection of the driveway. The next is some of the units that we have. We have the front unit. This is the view of the building that it would be from on Barrett Street. I'm right facing on Barrett Street. The right-hand side would be the actual, pointing towards Barrett Street, and the front that you see would be pointing on towards the proposed driveway. So they're nice looking homes. If you had an opportunity to visit Mr. Perry's development in Amherst, you'll see the quality and the style and the architecture of the buildings. You'll notice on this particular building, we show a solar collector on the roof. All of these houses have been arranged so they are solar-oriented. We're not guaranteeing that all the houses will have solar panel, but we have proposals to allow and orient the houses for solar collectors to make it more of a self-contained unit. These are the other units that you'll see. Again, this is what you would see as you were sitting in the park area in the middle. This is the view essentially of all the other remaining buildings. Again, nice architecture. I think that it's very pleasant. And this is difficult to see, but this is the front view of the proposed garages. You can see all the garages, doors that would be there. The owner of the garages would be predicated upon what you purchase as one of the condo units. The far left-hand corner of that, again, would be the recycle area. The very far right-hand side of that, there's an overhang, and the bike racks would be installed on that wall to hang up the bikes. Again, this is the overall project. I think trying to make this a presentation sort of short and sweet, but we do have buffers around the outside with plantings. Internal, I think we got nicely dressed up. The architecture, I think, speaks well for itself. And I think the ultimate thing is it sort of complies with the intent of the new zoning bylaws regarding infill. I think they're affordable homes. These are not McMansions. These are not out of reach for the people. I think it just, in this type of neighborhood, I think it just fits the character of the neighborhood, fits the style and size of the buildings that are required in this type of setting. I'm glad to answer some more questions, but I think that's a quick overview, enough to get the conversation started.
So that's the end of the presentation?
Correct.
So just for the audience reviewer, the steps will go through now. The board will ask the applicant any of our questions, and then we'll open it up for public hearing, and everyone who wants to will speak.
Please give us your name, your address, and be aware that if the point you want to make has been made, you can just agree with that and go on record with that. And we'll get through all the comments that we want. I'd appreciate going through one round of comments first before people return if they have something else to say. And then we'll close the public hearing, and then we'll discuss the project and vote on it. So, board members, questions? Dan.
Yeah, for the infiltration area, what's the depth to groundwater in that area?
Depth to groundwater varies, but it was about two or three feet deep. Varies, but we did 5 test pits. It was 2 to 3 feet down.
So from a detention, where's the volume for detention?
If I can show, in this area in the back here, one of the things that we wanted to do is, the other item I did not discuss during drainage is one of the other criteria that we have. There's really 3 criteria on drainage. One is to make sure we don't cause any downstream flooding or impacts on the neighbors to match pre and post. The other is water quality. We have to treat any, quote, dirty water. And dirty water was anything on the pavement. The roof water is considered clean, but all the pavement is considered dirty. And the upper right-hand corner, the existing home is almost like a high point from there. It sort of slopes down towards the stream. And in order to make sure that that pavement is treated, we sort of had to pick that back corner up. So the back corner is essentially in a fill situation. So the bottom of the detention basin is only about a foot or so below existing grade. And we had to pick the pavement, the surface area above that. So that area is not a very deep detention system. It's a pipe and stone type of thing. So it's very shallow, and that's why it's sort of large, is to hold the water. So we picked up the back. The ground slopes down, we picked it up, and they gave us room to put it underneath the ground. And then something I didn't really discuss, on the back side of that area, we actually have a small retaining wall, 3-foot-high retaining wall, to help us do that construction. And also that retaining wall sort of prevents or discourages the residents from going past that location, because we want to respect the wetlands, that whole 25-foot area and back in wetlands. So it's sort of a physical buffer, and also helps us to construct the detention basin and give us vertical separation to do that.
What's the rationale for sort of what looks like abruptly stopping the sidewalk right behind the first unit, where it sort of curves, and then I guess folks are encouraged to cross over? Is there a reason that, or
Well, we don't really need sidewalks coming down both sides of the driveway, so the driveway, the sidewalk is on the west side. We have the driveway, the sidewalk coming from Barrett Street, coming up on the left side, and essentially going around surfacing those homes, and then again on the right-hand side, the sidewalk coming down. And right, another thing I didn't bring out was at that location that you see right here, that's the gang mailbox. That's where the residents would stop, so people would walk down to the location, pick up their mailbox, and we have a crosswalk essentially from here to connect it. So we have the sidewalk essentially coming up this side. We have a sidewalk coming up the other side. We don't have a sidewalk going in front of the garages, but we do have the ability to cross and come out back down to Barrett Street.
Yeah,
and you briefly had on the side the snow detention plan, but it went away before I could get a really good look at it. Would you put it back?
I'm not sure which plan you would.
Well, it was off to the right-hand side of one of those. At least I thought I saw it.
I think it's on top of where the detention area is. Is that where the L4 snow is going to go?
Yes.
So that same
L4
in that area where the lines are is what. That's the primary snow.
L4.
What's this on the right-hand side there? What is that on the right-hand side? It says snow storage 1. What does that mean?
Those are locations. That's a separate insert to show you where we can store the snow.
That's sort of what I was looking at. You anticipate there would be snow in all of those, could well be snow in all of those areas.
Correct.
Is that the idea? And the drainage there takes the snow back to the northeast?
All of this area drains, essentially, as I said before, we sort of sloped all the pavement, goes towards the park in the center, and the way we collect the stormwater is around the perimeter of that park area. We essentially have a stone diaphragm. So the water from the pavement drains towards the park area, hits that stone diaphragm, goes down in the ground. We have a pipe that collects that water, sends it over to the detention system where it's treated first in a stormwater treatment system, and then put into the detention system and then slowly outlet it to the north.
Did the DPW ask for any revisions to your stormwater management plan?
No, not that I'm aware of, no. Oh, I'm sorry, they did. Memory back. One of their concerns was as I said before, we totally balanced the drain water, volume of water, rate of water going towards Barrett Street. They were concerned a little bit because some of the water from some of the water from the driveway is going to drain straight down into Barrett Street. They asked if we could remove a small section of the curb. Can't get my cursor to work here. We have a curb right now going all the way through here. They asked if we could remove a small section of the curb and encourage the water, rather than go straight into Barrett Street, to come and then slowly go across the lawn area, which would help to probably absorb it, slow it down. It goes to Barrett Street anyway, but that way they felt it would make it a little bit gentler, possibly have some of the grass absorb some of the water, so it would enhance what we have. Even though before we had complied with all the technical details, they felt would be an advisable scenario. So that would be another small thing that we would request that the board allow us to not have a curb here, or at least a flush curb for a very short distance right here to allow that water to dissipate across the lawn.
Let's see, another question about the stormwater management, although I heard what has been said that it's already been approved. Was there any bond or other kind of assurance required in case the doesn't work as intended and has to be redesigned and reconstructed?
Your DPW has come up with a good process of standard operation. When they issue a stormwater permit, one of the requirements that you have is you must sign an agreement There's a standard boilerplate agreement that the city DPW has, which essentially says you will follow your operation and maintenance process, and that you, if you don't do it, the city has a right to come in and maintain it, and they can backcharge you. It has to be signed by the applicant, has to be endorsed by the mayor and the DPW. So it's a formal process and agreement. That's a part of the stormwater permit that you have to obtain and execute that stormwater agreement, which ensures that it will be maintained and operated properly.
Is there ever, there's never a bond required, though?
I don't believe so.
Okay. Second question about the trees. There's a very large evergreen tree, I gather, about halfway down the driveway on the left.
Correct.
That's going to be removed. I'm wondering why it doesn't appear to be on the driveway.
It's, I could let Mr. Perry explain a little bit more about that, but there is a sidewalk. We're proposing a 5-foot sidewalk and a roadway going down that location. And by the time we construct that, it would impinge upon the tree. It is totally on his property as well. It's totally on his property.
Right.
I don't know if there's an overriding reason that, you know, we didn't try to save it as assessment tree at that particular point in time during the design process.
Gather the sidewalk probably could be put on the other side of the driveway, and then it would, the people walking down the sidewalk could access the mailboxes.
We looked at that as well. One of the things we wanted to utilize is the unit that's on the east side there has a side as a driveway coming up to the building, and we, based upon trying to keep that building single story at that location and being making it available for senior citizens, the size of the building, the driveway needs to accommodate a car. You can't have a 6-foot sidewalk and an 8-foot wide driveway. You have to be able to totally encompass the car on the driveway itself. So to put the sidewalk on that side there would essentially negate the ability to put that driveway on that building.
So there's no way that it could be designed to allow that tree to remain. The abutter has submitted a photograph of the tree, and it looks like a beautiful big tree. It's much larger than the ones, of course, that you'll be planting. I notice your rendering there probably shows what it'll look like in 20 years.
Correct.
Do you think it's possible to design it to retain that tree?
As a designer, I'm going to say anything's possible. I can't say it's not impossible to save that tree. I don't know if it's desirous from our perspective to save it or not. I think we would rather have the consistent trees throughout that location. Is it possible? Sure.
Thanks.
Question for Carolyn. Is there precedent for requesting a bond for the stormwater?
Sure. The board has the authority on any project to require some kind of performance guarantee. Excuse me. And it happens all the time for subdivisions, and particularly for the infrastructure related to stormwater management. And it's less frequent on special permits and site plans, but it's definitely an available tool. And what you would want to see is sort of the you know, you'd want to know what the cost of construction is beforehand, so you could put that in as a permit condition to say they have to post some letter of credit, third-party agreement, and you could just reference our subdivision regulations for the language, and that would be held until final inspections and certificate of, you know, basically that the engineers sign off that the design has been built according, or the structure has been built according to design.
What if the defect in the system may not be apparent for a year later?
That doesn't apply to after the fact misfunction.
Well, you could have it, you could establish so that it's in place and that then there's a sign-off by the engineer at the end of the construction of the project, but that the bond isn't released until, you know, there's a period of time in which it can be tested to make sure that it's operating as intended.
Can I address that briefly?
Yes.
The other common method, at least with a subdivision, as I know, I'm sure you know, is with a requirement that the home, that there be covenants under which the homeowners association going forward has to maintain and even sometimes report on the maintenance of the infrastructure, the stormwater management infrastructure. In this case, because it's a condo, there's really no reason why we couldn't put similar conditions in the condominium documents, which basically make the condominium association instead of the homeowners association responsible on a continuing basis for maintenance. And I think that's much more common from my understanding, that perhaps a bond until the engineer's sign off, but going forward, a continuing restriction that would be incorporated into the condominium documents, so it would be clear in the land records and to future owners of all units that this is a common responsibility of the condominium association to, for the continuing maintenance.
But just to add to that, the stormwater permit that is issued by the state, by the city,
requires
has that requirement that it has to be inspected by a professional. A report has to be submitted every October 1st right. of every year.
So this would be in the land records, both in the stormwater management maintenance and inspection agreement, and we can incorporate the reference to that into the condominium documents, so it's clear to all unit owners that this is a common responsibility and obligation of all the unit owners in the condominium.
And again, yeah. The agreement that is required to be signed by the applicant and the owner and the mayor enforces this document.
Yeah, I think the question that you all have is a little bit ahead of that schedule. The requirement has always been that the owners association, whatever form it is, has to maintain once they get a. Once they take obligation and ownership of such a system. We have had instances where several years after the fact, the system wasn't quite built according to the design specs because the contractor did something a little bit differently. And so there's a question about whether really it is functioning the way, and it has been a situation where then the developer has sold all the units and gone. And so the bulk of the issue is left with a homeowners association that doesn't know anything about this stuff and is just bought into it. So I think to the extent that if there is a concern that you want to make sure it's functioning first before it's handed over for the, you know, typical maintenance, you could do that, and that would be in your purview, and you could set a timeline, you know, so, you know, it has to, you could set it to the number of units that are sold or certificates of you know, occupancy or something, so half the units or whatever, because then there'd be some time that the system will be operational before all the units are sold, because that system has to be in place, has to start being in place by the time they start constructing units.
The actual permit that I'm looking at says that if after construction of the proposed system, the system is found to increase stormwater flows to adjacent properties or to the municipal storm drain system, the owner shall redesign and reconstruct the drainage system to prevent any increased stormwater flows to adjacent properties or to the municipal storm drain system. So again, this will be incorporated in the stormwater management agreement in the land records. So it's I guess what I'm trying to say is, I think this concern has been addressed, but I understand, you know, that your desire to look at it as well.
Yeah, I guess theoretically that should deal with the issue, but in fact, number one, if it's a dry year when it's built or the year after it's built, it may not be at all apparent that there's a problem. And number two, even if it's recorded, those restrictions are recorded in the Registry of Deeds, so what? Many times lawyers barely read those and don't bring them to their client's attention, and second, they ignore it at the time of closing, and if a problem arises a year or two later,
the condominium association may not have the ability to deal with it. I don't know. I mean, I'm just not impressed by the fact that it's recorded in the registry. There's nothing like a bond to be sure that it gets done.
Not to go one more time, but one of the requirements is that the DPW must receive a report once a year stating that everything is working well. It's not just by them, it's by somebody who comes and inspects it. And if DPW does not receive that report, they can come out and do the inspection themselves. That's an agreement, and it's a legal binding agreement. And if it's the owner does not repair it, DPW has the authority to come in and repair it, make it work, and charge the owner. So that document, legal document, exists.
I understand, but the owner may have sold off all the units. Hopefully they will have, and moved on to the next project, or moved out of state, or anything is possible. And the owners who are living there won't have the financial ability to rebuild it.
Right.
Maybe it won't become an issue, probably won't, but I think there could be problems.
Any other questions on any other issue?
Yeah, are you bringing the electrical utilities onto the site underground?
Correct.
So I was having a hard time seeing that on the plans. And so I understand that currently the overhead utilities also service 99 Barrett, and I'm just wondering how is that accurate?
It is. Yes.
Okay, and then so if you're bringing them underground, then how are you preparing to continue service for 99?
I can say that detail has not been worked out. Obviously, it would have to be. Obviously, has to be maintained to that adjacent parcel, and included the requirement for us to go underground. So I think we may have a single pole. I guess something we have to work out with the utility companies. So we really can't dictate that. That's just something that we work out currently with the utility company. I don't have a direct 100% answer for you.
All right, but you do have some leeway. I mean, it's not all directed by the utility company. You would have some design leeway to how you would like to bring it in and how you would like to address.
Correct.
Okay. I'd want to see something on that as I'm not sure what that would be, but I'm not comfortable kind of just leaving that open.
So ensuring that the other service that's on that pole now is put underground to at least the property line, so that the property owner could opt to.
What if the property owner didn't want it underground?
I would, but what if you didn't want your yard dug up?
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
You can check that.
Can I address that?
Yes, please.
Hello, I'm Shaw Perry, and I just wanted to address this particular issue. Our intent is to have all underground utilities. Mm-hmm. However, the actual design of the underground utilities is done by the power company. So we can maintain that we'd like to do one thing or another, but they're ultimately the designer, and we have to execute that design. Our intent is to have underground utilities, and I had previous discussion with the owner of the house next door, and I was told that they're interested in going below grade. Okay. And we would accommodate that. So as the lines are designed, that would be our request. If the next door neighbors would not like to have that, they could go on their property, probably place a pole and go back above ground.
Mm-hmm.
So there would not be a negative impact either way to their services. However, they could maintain the low grade, which is what they requested in a private meeting.
And would you pay for the service to go underground to their house?
We will do all the work that's required, yes.
Okay, thank you. Anything else on?
Can I ask again about that tree? I don't know whether anyone else, whether it's an issue for anyone else, and I wouldn't want to suggest imposing a requirement that be maintained if it would change the whole layout of the project. But if, on the other hand, I guess my question is, could it be left there with some minor redrawing? Would it have a
huge negative impact on the development.
So if I may address it again, I think that, as you probably know, there's only so much work that you could do in a proximity to a tree, particularly a tree of that magnitude. Their roots probably span 20 or 30 feet outside of that tree. The canopy is huge. And I don't think that there's any work that could be done there unless we completely change the whole project around. That road, in my opinion, would harm that tree detrimentally to the tree, and over the course of who knows whether it's 2 years or 5 years, that tree would have to come down. So if you like, maybe we can take the opinion of somebody who's an expert in the field and say what is the distance is required. But I think that even if we stayed close to this design, that tree would be harmed and would not sustain it. However, I think to the welfare of the community that lives there, the road, the utilities, and the sidewalks are important, and we would be replacing that tree with a variety of other trees. Beside the point, I can only tell you that we've had discussions with the neighbor, and the next door neighbor requested, showed interest in taking that tree down, and we were discussing taking exactly similar tree on the other side of the yard at the same time. So we were looking at taking two trees, one that was on my property and one in the adjacent property. So those trees may have seen the better of their lifetime.
There's one other thought I had about the trees, Alan, and that is the screening vegetation that is going in after that tree comes down can't go in when that tree's there. It can't grow underneath it. So I felt like creating a new visual border between the driveway and the house was advantageous to both sides, is one way of thinking about it. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other questions before we open it up? Do I hear a move? We
motion to open for comment.
Second. Tess and Ann seconded. So now we'd love to hear your comments. Come up and don't forget your name and address. Yes, please.
Yes, I'm Peg Murray. I live at 99 Barrett Street. I provided a detailed statement and a number of questions and concerns that I have as an abutter to this, to the development, to Caroline earlier, and I think she may have given that to you already. I'd like to read the two pages that are my statement, if that's okay, unless you have all read it and you would, have, would prefer to ask me questions.
We all received it and read it.
Are you okay with it then?
No, you know, if the audience, it wouldn't be impossible to read, but it would take some time. But I would say to you, I thought they were good questions and thoughtful. So we sometimes get letters that aren't nearly as worked out as yours.
So I will not read it then?
How about you summarize the topics? That would be great. And then the audience.
Why don't I read it? It takes 5 minutes. I've timed it.
Okay.
My name is Peg Murray. I live at 99 Barrett Street, which is located in the southwest corner, the rectangle to the southwest of the T there, from the property proposed for development. I grew up in the neighborhood, and I've owned my home and an easement to the driveway since 1984. During those years, I have consistently used and maintained the approximate 9 to 10 feet wide area immediately to the west of the driveway, and I have considered it my property. The area follows the length of my property. I am requesting that the area west of the driveway remain in its current state to protect my enjoyment of my home and to preserve the appearance of my property. The development of 95 Barrett Street should not change the physical appearance of my property from Barrett Street or adversely affect the view to and from my home. And I did attach photos for you. Not great photos, but they're there anyways. Based on the plans submitted by the developer, it is difficult to determine the actual paved area of the driveway, and the elevation of the driveway in relation to my land is unclear. Additionally, a buildup of the property to elevate buildings to the north of my property is likely to or may create additional water runoff to my backyard, which is already too wet. Plans are unclear as to how this project maintains or improves water drainage to the property of abutters. Again, I'm looking at 8.5 by 11 plans with a lot of stuff on them that I can barely see. I am, if this project is approved, I should not incur any expense in maintaining my connections for utilities. In fact, I shouldn't incur any expenses at all. I am also concerned with the proposal to locate the mailbox station immediately across from where I back out of my driveway, the shorter driveway. This will be a gathering place and traffic stopping place along the driveway, which will impose problems for my safe and sound access and my privacy. I am greatly concerned with the lack of attention to the effect of added runoff from a project of this size to the existing and well-known issues with the Barrett Street Brook. I believe 6 units of housing are allowed by right at 95 Barrett Street with site plan approval by the planning board, but this plan calls for 13 units of housing. Water and soil, which is heavy clay, on this property and surrounding properties should preclude this type of density in a neighborhood where housing and commercial development have caused wetlands, marshes, flooding to the detriment of homeowners on the street and beyond the neighborhood. While the theory of greater infill makes sense, the city needs to evaluate the bigger picture and how development has and continues to impact the larger areas surrounding neighborhoods and taxpayer properties. We've already read number 7 of the specific permit conditions for the stormwater management permit decision, and it states the proposed stormwater management system is designed to mitigate peak stormwater flows. If after construction of the proposed system, the system is found to increase stormwater flows to adjacent properties or to the municipal storm drain, the owner shall redesign and reconstruct the drainage system to prevent any increased stormwater flows to adjacent properties or the municipal storm drain, end of quote. It appears the owner would be the condo association, who doesn't have resources from day one, I'm certain. This condition makes it much too easy for the developer and the city to walk away from a failed stormwater management system. Carolyn just mentioned that there have been others, to the detriment of the property of neighbors and further flooding of the Barrett Street Brook. The owners, developer, engineers, and the city should share responsibility for a failed stormwater management system for perhaps 5 to 7 years of its operation. And a standalone, clear and conspicuous disclosure should be added to the buy-sell agreement, not at closing, not in the deed restriction, but at the buy-sell agreement where it's marketed, to alert buyers early on to this additional financial exposure to them as condo owners. I'm also particularly concerned with the lack of detailed and full traffic study showing the effect of additional traffic from this project on an already busy Barrett Street. Barrett Street currently services 3 existing residential developments, the business and medical practices on Carlin Drive, Jackson Street School, and the fire station. the street serves as a cut-through for traffic going to and from King Street. Saturday and Sunday traffic isn't bad, but when Jackson Street School lets out at around 3 p.m., traffic can frequently back up down below the Barrett Street Hill. Mornings at approximately 8:30 to 9 during school days are quite busy as well, with backups at the top of Barrett Street and on both sides of Jackson Street, with school buses coming and going and stopping below the hill at Hathaway Farms in the mornings and afternoons. As a straightaway and cut-through, automobiles generally travel up the Barrett Street Hill at elevated speeds, and I do it myself. drivers are frequently talking on cell phones, and speed limit signs are barely visible. The driveway to this project is approximately 110 feet from the top of Barrett Street Hill, and anyone coming or going from this driveway has a very limited time to get out on the street or into the driveway before traffic barrels up the hill. Efforts to slow down traffic on Barrett Street are way past due. The plans do not consider pedestrian or driver safety and how to minimize traffic impacts on the streets and roads in the area. It's difficult to see how this development meets most of the requirements of subsection 350-10.1.C of the city's ordinances for special permits. In the approval process, consideration should be given to the effect of adding 13 additional residential units to this already overstressed section of the city. If this project is approved for a special permit, we'd like the developer the developer should be required to provide updates on the project and status of this development with neighbors periodically and perform as a good neighbor. The issues and concerns above are the primary issues that affect my personal property and impact me as a resident of the larger neighborhood, area, and city. Attached is more detailed explanation of my specific concerns and questions to which I'm requesting responses. I've also attached photos, and I thank you for your time and consideration. I do have one other item that I'd like to read very quickly, and that is a petition by the abutters, which you should have received a copy of as well. And this is addressed to the Planning Board and Northampton Planning Board, and it says, the undersigned being abutters to property located at 95 Barrett Street, petition the Planning Board to deny the zoning permit application of Sunwood Builders for a special permit to construct 12 townhouse units and modify an existing unit on 2.1 acres of land located at 95 Barrett Street in Northampton. The granting of the application would further impact water and drainage issues in this neighborhood and would adversely affect our property. And it's signed by a majority of the abutters listed in the plans.
Thank you. Any questions? Sure. No. Someone else want to speak? Yes. Welcome. Mm-hmm.
No. Nope.
Yeah, don't forget your name and address.
I forget my name and address. I shouldn't be here because I really need some supervision. Okay, my name is Susan Enns, and I live at 74 Barrett Street. And okay, first of all, thank you. Second, land ownership and everything else is an illusion. Mother Nature just lends it to us all and sends us hurricanes, tornadoes, and all kinds of other natural forces to remind us of this. Last week, and I wrote this like for the last meeting before, so, you know, go with me. Last week I spent most of it in New Jersey, where I grew up and spent many years afterwards. New Jersey is a horror story for many reasons, nothing but corporations, shopping centers, and on and on. The aunt that I was visiting looks out of her front door and sees big houses built on wetlands using huge truckloads of dirt to fill it in, for example. The person who bought that property on Barrett Street, in my opinion, engaged in some kind of deceptive strategies, because they bought that place with the full intention to do what they are now proposing to do, instead of using it for a living space or a rental or something similar with maybe a few changes or with only what was there. We have neighbors who can't be here because they can't speak. They are the trees, plants, animals, all kinds, birds, and every other sort of living beings. I want them to have their rights since they were here first. I want them to be able to go up Barrett Street to Jackson. I want to be able to go up Barrett Street to Jackson and see what I've been seeing for years. I also want to stand in childlike wonder like I did one very late summer day last year in front of the school and watch a bald eagle and a red-tailed hawk peacefully, airily dance together against a very blue, cloudless, bright, sunny day again. Part two. The above was written up for the previous meeting. Okay, I said that. Yesterday I got caught in that pounding rainstorm as I was walking home. As I was going home, I went over the little place where the marsh empties out under the street. There was so much water flowing down that street that the water was massively backing up and pushing the water in reverse into the marsh. Anyway, that's it.
Thank you. Yes, sir. We'll get to both of you. Come on up.
Get it over with. Hi, my name is Mike Kirby, 134 North Street. And I'm here not because I live in the neighborhood, I don't, but that I've been following this issue for some time on my blog. And we have to think about, when we think about approving this permit, we have to think about the flooding that has taken part upstream in the church areas of Church Street and that whole area on the uphill side of the bike trail. And the reason we get this flooding is because of the fact that the area in the hill, Round Hill area, that whole area, it's a big watershed I think it's 100 or more acres. And the water doesn't arrive at the choke point, at the first choke point, which is the inlet into the marsh, until sometime later. Whereas the water that comes down Barrett Street and on the and also comes down on the stream behind this development, and they call it an intermittent stream. I was down there the other day. It was flowing. It's not a huge brook, but it's a brook. And what is this? This water comes down first, and what she said is true, that it pushes into the marsh. It pushes into the marsh, and it means that you have flooding upstream. And we did a big project about 15 years ago, 10 or 15 years ago, in which was state money to dredge the brook. And the bridge, and since then there has been no dredging by the Department of Public Works, even though they pledged to dredge it regularly. The channel is occluded. All the water from a big portion of the city ends up in, I think, is a 48-inch sewer that goes into the Connecticut River. And right now, there's a tree falling in front of it, and there's branches. It's just downstream, it's not prepared to take more water. And I think the one thing you have to, there are two really important things. One was that you have a lot more impervious surface now, don't you? What's the ratio?
So, Mr. Kirby, could I get you to use the microphone, please, so that we'll get on recording? So I'd rather you speak to us.
Okay, right. Well, I think if you look at the figures, you'll see there's a lot more impervious area, and that's the bottom line. Also with it, it's also, they have admitted that the water table is high. The water isn't going to go in the ground. It's going to go on Barrett Street, and it's going to go into Hathaway Farms. Mm-hmm. And when I walked around Hathaway Farms, I got tales from people on how bad the flooding is in the parking lot. The developers are telling us that water is from his, is going to go into that occasional waterway. It's not. It'll overload and end up in the parking lot, and then it's going to end up in the area where the people in Hathaway Farms walk in every day. So I urge you to think big on this. I just got a mailing from the mayor saying we have to think about climate change, the fact that the world is getting warmer and wetter. So we're going to, here we have a development that's smack in the worst part of the city in terms of flooding. I don't think there's been any effort made to make sure that the pipe that this is, and a lot of this thing it runs into, is clear and free. So essentially, I urge you to think about what this is, a small development, but still it's a significant development. And anybody that's been on Barrett Street when it's really raining knows that it has too much water coming down too fast.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm Yvonne Boucher, 159 Jackson Street. My land abuts the back where they have this beautiful kind of construction of collecting water. It looks to me like it might be 25 feet across, judging from 20 feet across. And I'm not sure about that. Now, the first thing I want to address this is, in some of your literature, it says if there is a serious detrimental use of the land, which here is the impact on the integrity of the row of single-family houses, you will consider it a little more seriously. Then it says also in the zoning thing, the building has to face the street. I didn't see any of them facing the street, especially that first one that's supposed to be near the street. That's supposed to be the other way, all right? So that you have a visual kind of thing that meets the requirements of the city. Then I want to know if there is a rain of 1 inch, 2 inch, 3 inch, 4 inch. How is that going to work? Okay. You have all those trees on top of it? There'll be leaves that will accumulate on it. What are they going to do that with that? Now there's this beautiful condo that's on Hatfield Street. What's it called? Town Common, Old Town Commons. They had four trees in the center there where their parking lot is, okay? They died. Those trees are probably going to die because of that water accumulation. Those, what are they, five maple trees that they have? Okay, if they die. Okay, and the association says, well, there's always trash in there anyway, so that let's pave it, okay? What do we have in the way of recourse that maybe 3 years from now or 4 years from now, when they are sick and tired of all the leaves falling on the thing and the stuff clogging up and all the bottles and things that are on there, what are we going to have in the way of recourse if they're going to cut all those six trees, or if they, because they're all dying or something's wrong with them, and paving the whole thing over, making it really ugly. Okay, he was talking about senior citizens in the front of that unit. No, I don't think so, because the handicapped accessible parking are in the back on that side and on that side. On the plan, I was not able to see what the difference in height will be. Okay, there's this line that says, well, this drains toward this side, this that way. But one of those accessible handicapped parking spaces, it says there's going to be a ramp. A ramp means you go up. So there's a differential in the height there, which is not marked anywhere that I could see. There's another one on the other side, and that one he acknowledged on the right-hand side by there where that detention thing is. That way he acknowledged they're going to raise that, okay? And there's another handicapped accessible there. Now to that center thing, there are two entrances to it. And I feel that's probably because the land is lower, okay? Which means that they're also going to retain water. If that thing doesn't work in the back, all that snow when it melts is going to just go down into that hole. That will be another reason for saying, oh, this is just like a mess, like a swamp. We don't need a swamp down there. We can never use it. So why don't we pave it? Okay. Yes, that's about... Oh, yes, he's also supposed to provide 11% of buildings that are affordable. Did anybody check that out? I'd like somebody to check that out because that hasn't been mentioned. Okay. So that's about all, because I can't verify any of the thing. The plans that I have, they give the directions how to find it on the world map, you know, longitude and latitude, oh, very nice, but it doesn't tell me if it's 65 feet across or 12 feet across. Now, that walkway for people, huh? On the back, there isn't any. He acknowledged that, there isn't any, but that's where the trash goes. So if I am on that front building there, or I'm on the other side of that front building, I go up so far, and then I have to go on the pavement where the road is, okay, to get to the trash thing. So I don't know what they're going to do about that, okay? Because that's quite a few people there that are going to go to the trash and to the recycling center every day, okay? So I hope you're going to consider that.
Thank you.
Of course, I'm upset to get... from a city that seemed to be so open, so wonderful, so quality life conscious, to something that's going to do infill everywhere and it's going to look like Holyoke or Springfield.
Third time's charm.
Good evening. My name is Joe Leahy. Along with my wife Frances, we live at 83 Barrett Street. If you look at these plans, just look to the right of those six condos, and that's our property. Before I get into that, I did a little research, and By the way, Mr. Kirby, you were correct. The tire and roof is going from 814 square feet to 36,000 square feet. And given the fact, well, many years ago, I was on the Conservation Commission in Springfield, I saw a lot of these projects come. And it's great, when they come before you, they make a lot of promises. I did notice there was a little resistance to offering a bond, maybe because that might have to be paid down the road. But keep that in mind. A lot of promises are made, but after it's all done and everybody's gone, the neighbors are left with it. I did a little research, and I noticed in September 2004, the City Council approved a flood mitigation plan. And one of their priorities was to maintain the integrity of the 200-foot wetlands barrier, or buffer. We're 30 feet from the wetlands here. You know what? Especially in urban areas today. They've been built, swamps have been filled in, garbage has been dumped, and things have been built on top of them. And let's just look at Barrett Street. We found out, if you don't mind passing out a few pictures, this is what our backyard pool looked like, and that's the other three pictures show what it looks like now. We found out about this project. We were halfway through that project, which was extremely expensive. It's all stamped concrete. Everything's been redone out there. There's lighting, there's plantings. We had already signed our contract. The water that we get on our property, and Mr. Kirby's correct, when there's a bad rainstorm, the Hathaway Farms parking lot fills with water. Our cellar floods. We have a sump pump. It doesn't just come up through the floor. It comes through the walls. And when it comes through the walls, it squirts through the walls. My wife's an expert at putting dry lock on the basement walls every year. The interesting thing I found out, she bought it from her twin sister. They had the twin sister, her and her husband, bought it from the original builder, the guy that built the house for his family. When it was built, it had a finished basement. As soon as the old Hampton Gardens was built, they started to get a flooded basement. And that's quite a distance across our backyard to hit Hampton Gardens. No matter you build something, the water's going to go somewhere. This talk of a retention area, the problem is the water table's too high. We've got a young lady right over here in the second row. She's lived on Barrett Street for 50 years, or more than 50, a couple more than 50 years. Never had water in her basement. Now she's on the other side of Barrett Street. Up towards the top of Barrett Street, a colonial home was built. As soon as that house was built, she had water in her basement. She now has two sump pumps. We have another abutter going up Barrett Street towards Jackson Street School that has spent $60,000 trying to resolve the water problem in their basement, and it's still not right. They still get water in their basement. There's another couple issues, and I know they've got approval, all their permits in place. DPW signed off on a Conservation Commission, blessed it. But nobody here has talked about the existing traffic on Barrett Street. Oh, man. Just quick estimates I've done. We have to get at least 5,000 cars a day up and down Barrett Street. Doesn't surprise me. Most days when I try to back it on my driveway to go to our business in Springfield, I wait, you're bored, you count the cars. Well, maybe I can get out by 25 this morning. Bottom line is, we've got too much traffic as it is now. The comments that were made earlier, it is a cut through. And also with the development, the other developments, the fire headquarters and so forth, there's a lot more traffic in the area. The other part of it is, show me a neighborhood in Northampton that has 298 units, rental units. Now there's some condos, but very few in that number. They all enter and exit within 100-foot zone. 298 units. Do the math on those, the number of cars that are coming in just on those three projects. We all know the problems on Barrett Street. You know, coach-like condos. Every time there's been a hard rainstorm, a city's down there pumping out their basement or pumping out their building. We don't need more development. We don't need more water being pushed elsewhere. Our neighborhood's never going to go back to the way it was years ago, and we know that. What we're asking for is, we've given enough. Everybody makes their money, and then they go back to the communities they come from. One of the problems I have, and I'm sure there's some sentiment within the neighborhood that opposes this, is we've heard all the promises, and the promises aren't kept. I remember when the fire station was built, the headquarters, neighbors in Barrett Street area, Denise Court, were promised that no fire department trucks or vehicles would be on Barrett Street unless they were responding to an emergency. I can tell you right now that that promise has been long forgotten. In fact, if you can, most mornings you can, we walk our dogs, we have two Goldens, you can stand out on Barrett Street at 5 of 8, and you can watch one of the higher-ups in the fire department come screaming down Barrett Street at 45 to 50 miles an hour on his way to work. Number one, he's not supposed to be on the street, and obviously he shouldn't be speeding. But unfortunately, that's what we have on Barrett Street. We have a sign that says the speed limit is 25 miles an hour in front of our house. You can't even read the two. You can barely make out it's so old and worn. So I'd be happy to answer any questions, but I can tell you this. Dealing on a conservation commission, like I said, these guys are going to be all long gone. They'll have made their money. We're stuck with the problem. I do have an alternative. I know there's some money around from time to time to acquire properties. If you think for a second, this would be a great piece of property to acquire for school science programs. Hell, you could even put a community garden out there for the 298 people that live in apartments on our street. But it is an alternative to the existing plans. Thank you.
Thank you. Someone else? Yes, sir?
My name is Phil Appleton. I live at 44 Pine Hollow in Amherst. And we have lived for 3 years in Sunwood Pines, which is the similar development over in Amherst. And I hear all the grievances and concerns and everything. And the only thing I'd like to speak to is how the integrity that Shaul Perry has. And he's always around, and he's a man of his word. And he's been there for 10 years. We've only been there 3. All I've heard in the last 3 years is how great he is and how he takes care of everything, above and beyond warranties, whatever. He likes to keep everyone happy. So I know the concerns about someone just making the money and leaving. I have not seen that in my experience with him.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And I think you got 10 of the neighbors signed a petition on that.
Hello, Maureen Carney, 13 Church Street, and City Councilor for Ward 1 in this area. I'm speaking as a resident, but also as a representative of folks out on Barrett Street. My biggest concern is, of course, the water issues that were raised. Personally, my home's been flooded at least 2-3 times, and really drastically just a year ago. The south end of the Barrett Street Marsh, and all of those things that Mr. Kirby said earlier. The hydrology in that area is just something that really concerns me, and I just hope you would really take that strongly into consideration, even though the permits were granted from DPW and the Conservation Commission. So thank you very much.
Okay. I did say we could have a second round. Yes, ma'am?
Yes, I just wanted to add on the discussion of the pine trees. No formal decision has been made on those at this point. We have talked about them. It was one of the few discussions we've had so far, open discussions. So I just wanted to make that clear. No decision has been made. I have provided a claim of adverse possession on that strip of land. You should be aware of that. In terms of the retention basin. A couple of us went to visit the DPW to talk about the stormwater approval process, and my understanding was that there's a filter in that drainage all around the open area, and so if I believe if snow is being placed anywhere, it should be within that so it can filter before it gets to the retention basin, but I'm not, that was my understanding from our discussion. The DPW did not have a copy of the revised plans showing the snow removal and that process, so they were going to get that, and that was just a couple of weeks ago. The other condition that the stormwater individual told us about was that the state does not consider the impervious surface when the soil is clay. They do not consider the volume of water that comes into the area, because clay is almost the equivalent of paving and rooftops and all of those things in terms of its ability to absorb water. Of course, clay is going to absorb some water more so than paving and rooftops, and I think the Doug McDonald, who was the stormwater expert for the city, agreed that there should be some consideration given to that fact, that clay will absorb more than a pavement would.
Okay.
So I just wanted to raise that issue.
Thank you. Make it brief.
One of the things besides all the other stuff I just said, I'm still Susan Enns, by the way, is the fact is when I live at the Coach Lake, and I live on the parking lot side, and I grew up in the woods. I've spent a lot of time living in the woods. When the marsh floods, it's to some extent it's okay. But I want everybody to know that the marsh is a nursery for baby animals. It's a place where the frogs and the toads, et cetera, breed. It's a place where the animals find shelter and the birds have their nests and things. And what's really important is that's a treasure, it's a gem, it's a special place where a lot of life that doesn't happen elsewhere happens. And I really think that this is a really bad idea, because if we have too much flooding, certain species of animals are not going to be able to conduct their lives the way they should. And considering the traffic on the road with all the animals that are going back and forth and whatnot, hey, you know, we don't want to have any, I don't want to see any dead animals, because simply this, so the people are speeding too much and there's too much volume. Anyway.
Thank you. Okay, any other last first round comments? Okay, do I hear a move to close public hearing?
So moved.
Before you do that, you might want to keep it open in case during your discussion you have questions for the applicant.
Advice from counsel, so to speak. So we'll start our discussions now. And so we're not going to close public comment so that we could ask questions back and forth, but it's sort of for us to work out our own thoughts about the project now. And to that degree, let's go.
Did we have any discussion about where the water is draining off the roof and whether it's going directly underground or whether it's draining on the ground?
I would assume that's one component of the stormwater management plan.
Yeah, I just wondered which way they were.
Yeah.
It's being directly shuttled into the...
There will be some areas of, there's different soil types on different parts of the property. There's a significant amount of clay type soils that don't infiltrate very well at all. And that's why they're considered essentially to be soils that can't infiltrate. So there's no accounting for that under the stormwater regulations. In terms of calculating infiltration, it's it's considered impervious, essentially. But there will be some areas of infiltration, and then there'll be overflows to a retention area that will ensure that the peak flows that are currently going off the site, because currently a lot of water is going off the site, it's shedding off because it can't infiltrate.
But I'm talking about what comes down off the roof. Is it coming down off the roof into a pipe and directly below ground?
No, there'll be some surface shedding from the roof, but it'll be on, it's directed in a different way than it currently is on site. There's no management of the water on site now, and so the grading plan will show and will direct the water into those areas that will catch it and then direct it towards the rear of the site. So the, you know, to the extent that now water is seeping through the clay layer and making its way to foundations and other places down hill, a lot of that will be directed towards the rear of those properties instead of being allowed to seep in.
I also wanted to know what we think is going to happen to the money that they are putting aside as a mitigation for the traffic questions.
Yeah, so that would be utilized within the vicinity, so in the neighborhood, to address pedestrian safety, potentially traffic. There hasn't been a speed study. We don't know what, if there is a speeding problem, and whether it would be appropriate to do anything about that. It obviously is a public street that connects to other streets, so it could be used by anybody in the city.
Is there a possibility of putting a crosswalk there so that the children who live in this thing can go across the street in a designated place where the sidewalk is? It's on the wrong side, and they're going to be going to that school up there.
Right. Potential. So the city does not create mid-block crossings outside of course, downtown. It's not a safe scenario to do that, and so we've been moving away from that.
So it's just safe to run across the street to the other side?
Well, there are...
There's no sidewalk.
There's no sidewalk on that side. Just as the other houses, any of the people who live on that side of Barrett Street, if there are children in those homes, then they would cross.
I know, but we're just adding a lot of people is what I'm thinking.
But we also know that the persons per household in multifamily is below, right around one and below one when you're talking about multifamily and condominium units like this. So we don't anticipate... there will be a huge number of school-aged children. There may be a few, but it's certainly not the trend in Northampton.
Well, and I, to answer your question about who handles the traffic mitigation money, that would go to the process that's run by the Transportation and Parking Commission. And I agree with the city not having mid-block crossings, but there's also an awful lot of research that said putting crosswalks at mid-blocks are no safer because people feel protected when in fact they aren't. So I think your children are going to cross the street. The answer is yes, they are. And we need to teach them how to do that is really the point.
I mean, the alternative, what we've done with other projects is, you know, depending on what the neighborhood interests are, we start potentially building those open segments. So this project will have a segment of sidewalk across the frontage. Money could be applied to continuing that sidewalk towards the school on that side, but you also need to, I couldn't tell you that that's an appropriate way to use the money
that.
Because we don't know about the right of way width and all that.
It's a very tight street.
Right.
It's a very tight street. It doesn't look like there's any extra in the it's not the kind of street you would walk in the way you might some other streets.
No, I agree with that.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, the DPW's stormwater permitting process, does it really account for the complex hydrology that we're looking at here? I mean, that's... I'm wondering what level of modeling is done taking into account soils, flooding, the wetland. You know, my imagine it's probably based on a sort of a standardized model, and this isn't really a standard site, and I'm just curious if you have any awareness of that.
Yeah, I mean, it is a standard site in that each site is different, has different soil types, and for each site, applicants have to provide and do a soils analysis as part of the stormwater calculations. And you have to look at the watersheds and the subwatersheds within the area. We know as a city about the problems up south and upstream with the Barrett Street Marsh watershed, and the city has a consultant right now doing a more in-depth and concerted study about the entire watershed going up to the Round Hill drainage watershed area. And that is essentially upstream. So the drainage from this area would intersect what we call the King Street Brook north of Barrett Street. So it would be coming, I could show you on Google Earth, but it's north of where there are other and different flow problems in the Barrett Street Marsh. And the city created a channel in that brook that takes water to the Connecticut River. But they improved that channel 10, maybe 15 years ago, and they regularly maintain that channel. And that's where this drainage area would be running toward. But yes, it is a bigger watershed, and yes, there are problems, and yes, but now the city is looking at it in a bigger way. What we don't have is, we don't have any ordinances that say on the book, city council hasn't adopted anything that says, when we have X, Y, and Z conditions, when we have high groundwater or clay soils, we're not gonna allow any more development. We're not gonna allow people to expand their homes to build extra bedrooms. We're not gonna allow people to put pools in because we know that just exacerbates the condition for the area. We haven't said that as a city. So there isn't anything in the ordinances that says planning board needs to look at soils in an area, and if it looks like there are drainage issues that are currently affecting other properties, then don't approve any more development, don't approve expansions or anything like that. So without that, and the fact that the ordinances that we do have relating to stormwater runoff been applied in this situation, and the applicant has met those standards that are very specific, they have been granted a permit that shows that they are not going to have a detrimental effect on the abutting properties. We also want to make sure that it gets constructed the way it's designed, and to that end, just like with subdivisions, you can impose, performance guarantee to show that it does get done, and that's a little bit more at sort of closing the loop and tightening the assurances more than the language that says at the end of the project you submit an as-built showing that it's built according to plan, and then because that money then wouldn't get released until such a time that that those assurances are made, so it's not left to the end user to take care of later. And that, if you feel that you want to make sure that everything is designed accordingly, you could impose that kind of condition. It's definitely an option for you all to consider.
I have a related but different question. I don't know if it's for other board members or for you, Carolyn, but I'm trying to understand, in general, how aggressive a stormwater management design this is. Just looking at the plans that we've reviewed, what does a more aggressive plan look like? Does it involve green roofs and permeable pavers, or is this pretty much as aggressive and you know, as it could be, setting aside that a permit has been issued for stormwater management, you know, just kind of textbook landscape design, you know, how aggressive is this?
Well, again, it goes back to the site conditions, and you can't have permeable pavers if you don't have the soils underneath it to support it. So the applicant has shown an area where they're capturing and they're trying to infiltrate to the extent that they can. So we do require that, and they are doing that, and it's because of the soil condition that they can't do more.
Okay.
We don't have a requirement to do green buildings
right.
with green roofs, and that adds, that's a whole nother structural engineering issue that's very expensive.
Yeah.
And
so given current conditions, the plan as designed is as aggressive as it can be? Is that
yeah.
a fair characterization? I mean, I don't know if the applicant would agree with that, or
you can ask what their opinion is.
Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I may speak. Go back to one other question. Yeah,
just so it'll be on the record.
We have done detailed calculations. It's not just a landscape plan showing some shallow areas. We go into detailed analysis of the site. We subdivide the area, determine the existing ground cover type of soil, hydraulic soil group that it has, generate a computer model of the entire site to determine what the existing runoff conditions are. We remodel the entire site after development, determine what the new rate of runoff is. And then we develop and design attenuation and drainage systems and incorporate that in the computer model as well. And that's how we come up with the numbers. We don't just throw these things out here. We check the velocities of the water going through the pipe, the velocity of the water that goes across the ground, make sure it doesn't have erosion factors. So it's not just a little.
Oh, yeah. No, I wouldn't suggest that was the case. I'm just trying to understand, you know, I'm sure that another firm might design something different, and what is, you know, what would the net result be?
We obviously look at trying to do LID, low impact development processes, and based upon the soils, we felt like we were as aggressive as we could be.
Mm-hmm.
We do know, I mean, in our drainage calculations, we know where the detention basin is, that there will be some infiltration, but to be conservative, we ignored that number in our calculations just to make sure we weren't misleading people.
Mm-hmm.
Just to clarify an earlier question, the roofs are directed through pipes to the detention basin, except for the very front portion of the front building, that is not, but the rear portion of that first building is directed through pipes all the way back to the detention basin. So we captured as much of the impervious area as we could, so we could capture it, slow it down, and make sure it doesn't leave the site any faster than current conditions. So the answer quite, we were aggressive and did a lot of detailed work on the drainage for a project. We knew it was a sensitive area, so we did spend the time and effort to do that.
Well, and I appreciate your description of the process you go through to analyze it, because I think that that is why we as a planning board with the expertise we bring to it are not the people that evaluate the stormwater management plan. Mm-hmm. So once they've gone through that step, I feel like we've had the people at the city level with the most expertise evaluating whether that's adequate or not. So the DPW does that and then gives them the certificate, and that's kind of where we start the discussion about the project.
And there also have been some other problems on Barrett Street that are sewer-related problems with the Coach Light condominiums. The pipe wasn't constructed at the right
scale.
Grade, so there's back up sometimes into those basements. So there has been pumping related to sanitary, not stormwater. Necessarily. We also had some infiltration of stormwater into the system that I think DPW has taken care of over the last several years. But that historically was an issue previously.
Other thoughts? I can speak to the area I think I know about, which is traffic. And I might even suggest that you used the single family ITE number as opposed to the condo, which was a more onerous metric for you to have pulled. generally the guidance from the Institute of Transportation Engineers says if you're going to add more than 100 units, you need to do a full-blown traffic analysis. And this doesn't even begin to approach that, so that's why there's some limited treatment of how the traffic will affect the neighborhood. And the two metrics that matter are whether traffic is increased at peak hours, which is usually commuting hours, morning and evening, or in overall, how much does the average traffic on the street increase because you're adding units. And this institute collects survey data to give them numbers that they use to try to estimate what the increased traffic will be. And they used a very conservative, they used the single family number, which is slightly higher than if you use the condo number for that. And let's see. The estimate is that in a peak hour, it would add 6 is the number they used. And in average daily traffic, there'd be 128 extra cars spread out through the entire day. So those are the numbers that came in. They did do a traffic analysis, but a limited one rather than a full-blown one because of the scale of the project. My comment about that is it looked good to me. It's the kind of work I wanted done there. Yes, sir.
Can I possibly make another comment? I'd love to speak for one moment to propose to you the outlook of somebody that isn't here tonight is the people that are going to live there. So if you approve this project, I think that what you're going to find out that we are encouraging infill in the town, and I think that that's been something that the town has been looking for. I think that the site is just happens to be a classic place to add this type of a development to the town. This is not within a very dense area. However, it's within a street that has variety of apartments and already density is already in the street. The other thing that I wanted to touch on is just the quality of life that's going to be there and the affordability, energy efficiency. We are required to be more energy efficient, I believe 25% of the current code, which we'll be complying to. We're going to do a solar array that's going to be shared by the homeowner association that everybody is going to be a party to. We're going to create that park and we're going to create a community. And I think that being the proximity to downtown, there's many people that could be traveling either walking to Main Street, riding a bicycle, and I think that's going to meet the requirements of the bylaw.
Okay, let's take this back over. Thoughts? None from John? Carla?
I mean, I'm really sensitive to the concerns that the neighborhood has presented to us tonight, the water issues, but I, sort of repeating your words, I feel that we have to rely on the engineers with DPW and the calculations that were done by the project engineers to inform us on that. And everything that's come back to us is that they're meeting the standards that the city has. Traffic mitigation. I would like to think that the money that the project has to pay would be used in the immediate vicinity to address some of these concerns. I again understand that's out of our purview. I don't believe we.
The Transportation Parking Commission will use that traffic mitigation money within that area. They are constrained to do that.
Okay. All right. Good. Otherwise, I don't think anything I think everything that's been presented follows zoning. It follows the code, and I don't see any reason that I wouldn't vote yes on it based on that.
Can I just add, there are a couple of notes that I think the board's touched on. It also relates to some of the comments that I think you all heard from the public comment. But a couple of issues I noted. One is, so there is a requirement. There was a question about affordability. And so there are two mechanisms by which to sort of meet that standard. You can either create dedicated affordable housing units or
construct a percentage of the units to be 1,200 square feet or less. So the applicant has opted for that mechanism for under the housing. They've noted that that 10 of the units will be 1,200 square feet or less, but it's not clear which ones are planned for that. I think it would be important to understand which they are and have it clear in the permit condition, so as the applicant applies for building permits, that can be sort of checked off at the building level to make sure those units that were designated are the ones.
It was clear on the plan.
I'm not sure if...
It's called out on the plan.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's on each of the plans, which one is going to be less than 1,200? Okay, I didn't see that. Okay. Then there was a little bit of discussion of the lighting and spillover. I don't know if you wanted to discuss that and whether you thought that was appropriate or if shields on the back sides of those lights should be installed to ensure that there's a cutoff right there at those three points that...
One had to do with the neighboring house.
Right, yes. Right.
And one had to do with the street.
Right. So the street one maybe is not such a big concern, but the other ones that are in the project might be appropriate to address that. And then the way the zoning is set up the way the design standards are established is that if a structure is oriented with doors and yards that face, you know, that are at opposite angles or perpendicular to abutting yards, that instead of the normal 15-foot side setback, there'd be either a 20-foot setback or additional planting. And there's a 15-foot side setback on this side here. I think the issue is right in this area. And these houses are oriented. There is a front door that faces the street here, so, and with a covered entry, which is consistent with the design requirements, but there's still sort of front back yard. So I would suggest that this really needs to be a 20-foot setback or additional planting. So that might need to be explored a little bit.
But you thought the plantings would not work because of the swale?
Right. That was a question I raised, that whether or not additional planting screening could go in there. So that's a question probably for the applicant to address before you close the hearing. And I think this was another edge, or I guess it was this edge here as well.
So that's on the east edge.
Right.
So these are the units are marked in the...
Okay, perfect. Okay.
These are the larger units.
Okay.
All right. So that took care of that one.
Can we ask the designers on whether or not...
Sure.
...plantings or screening could be done on the eastern border?
Yeah, absolutely. On that easterly border, the grading plan does show a swale. It's a very gentle swale. There's, like I say, 15 feet there. We would have no objection whatsoever to putting a planting along the property line at that location. Just to go through the variances again, variances, waivers. Then we also want to remention the curb, the elimination of the standing curb on the portion of the driveway right adjacent to Barrett Street.
Mm-hmm. What are you suggesting for planting along that to create a heavier screen? I think the board needs to know what that would be.
I would anticipate that we would mimic what we have over here. I believe it's a line of arborvitae. I think they're 4 to 6 foot high arborvitae along this location. And I would imagine that we would just mimic that in this location as well. Okay. Yeah, there is an existing fence, a stockade fence there. It's not on our property. We would not be able to,
How tall is that?
I think it's about 4 feet for the first half. I don't know if it jumps up as you go further north or not.
4 feet.
It's 4 feet, I believe. But we would
further
be...
Further north is a taller metal fence behind it.
We would be, you know, glad with the condition, put a stockade, but a stockade fence next to existing stockade fence may be a little cumbersome. We do have adequate room to put in a row of shrubs there for assuming the arborvitae, which makes a nice screen.
It's a pretty creative solution is what I feel like it is. And that may be fine. I'm giving you what my thoughts are, is that I was not aware we had the contract in place until this project came up. So I'm in some ways relieved to hear that we have that. I think the developer will be involved in the project for some time. And I, you know, what we're all hoping is that has some rain experience that tells us whether what he's done is an improvement or not. And that's, I hear you from your legal background saying we're not going to go after individuals in order, you know, 12 separate individuals, but I think there is a legal mechanism in the contract that's in place for the city to remediate the project and then have that as a lien against the condo itself.
Well, I mean, maybe you can think about it a different way. This, I think, this happens in every subdivision that you all approve. There is a permit requirement that a maintenance and schedule be recorded, and the homeowners association is required to maintain that system once they take ownership of the property. On top of that, as the subdivision is built out, there's a whole list of the costs to construct the subdivision and a letter of credit, bond, whatever third-party agreement is established based on those construction costs. And the planning board reduces that as the subdivision gets built out, but there's always, you always hold on to a bit of it until the construction is complete.
You said planning board, that's the planning office.
Planning board.
Board.
The planning board, as the subdivision rules require that a bond be put in place for a new subdivision, which includes all that drainage infrastructure as well as the street infrastructure. So this is not unlike that scenario where you also have the long-term maintenance requirements, but the upfront cost, and the whole point of that is to ensure that it gets built as designed and that the end user isn't on the hook for an incomplete project or something that isn't quite built the same way. And we have had subdivisions where the board has held out that last bit of money to make sure that things are corrected in the stormwater system before it's released and before the developer can say, okay, I'm done here. Now I'm handing it 100% over to the homeowner. So that happens regularly under subdivision. It's just something you don't use frequently under site plan and special permit. And so I wouldn't be worried about the fact that you already have, you know, the legal document, the permit that requires a recording of the maintenance agreement, on top of any other mechanism for the front end, the construction. It may not be 100% of the units because, again, it might take a long time. I think after 50% of the, you know, we have 13 units here, the infrastructure has to be in place pretty much. You know, if they build half, let's say, it's already going to be most of this area, most of the impervious is going to be covered under, you know, I would say within 50, construction of 50% of the units. So I think you're going to know whether the system is working as it was designed to work. And in terms of understanding what that amount would be, the permit condition, if you decide to do that, could state that the final amount for the performance guarantee will be determined. Actually, it could come back to the board for you to agree to that before they can start construction. So you can do it prior to construction. The planning board has to sign off on the final amount of that bond. So what we would do is collect the actual cost to construct that system. And put a contingency on top of that for, you know, whatever inflation, et cetera. And then bring it to the board for you just to sign off on the money part of it, because that's your purview, is to look at that and then release it at the end. Staff can't release it or make the final determination. And in a subdivision, just to further clarify, under a subdivision review, the draft construction quantities are always submitted as part of the package, so you get a sense of how much this whole project is going to cost. In this case, you don't have that, and it's really just a small part of it. You're not talking about the road and everything else. You're just talking about the drainage piece of it.
So, back to sort of get some summary here. I'd love to cover any other questions, but I'd also like to start working towards the conditions that we would certainly have to consider for the project. I'm not bothered. In fact, I like the light spill onto the road, so right. I only want the shielding of the light for the neighbor.
Right.
The electric service, I would want assurance that the developer handles the expense of any changes made to the electric service of the abutters. There would be east edge planting of arborvitae screen.
Demand of clarification, is that needed along the entire east edge or just this southern portion?
Just the southern portion.
Just the southern portion,
okay. So yes, from there down. Extended to the street, maybe would say that.
I don't think it needs to. I think it needs to go to the edge of this structure, and then you don't want to create a site distance issue with for traffic. Okay. So,
and the curb, the lower curb,
right
on that side as well.
I'm sorry. I'm
allowing the curb to.
Yes.
Not
thank
place.
You. Okay, so now we need to work out the wording on what you've just discussed, Carolyn, which would be that we request a final amount of a performance bond guarantee.
So you could have it, you know, prior to construction. The applicant must post a
well, first bond. Cost out that segment of the work.
Right. So we have this pretty standard language that prior to construction, the applicant has to post a performance guarantee that's in compliance with our actually it's the planning board's general standards in the subdivision regs, but before that's posted, the amount has to be approved by the board. And then if you want to stipulate the timeline for how long that stays in effect, you can do that as part of that condition as well.
Are you all comfortable with the 50% of the property transacted?
Yeah, or would you just say until ownership is transferred to the homeowner?
I mean, you could say 1 year after completion of the stormwater infrastructure, or 50% of the units.
But doesn't the whole issue of stormwater get more difficult to handle once there are more roofs?
Right. So actually, that's right. So I guess the issue would be the timing. So let's pretend 50% of the units gets done, you know, within 1 year of creating the system. Do you want it for a longer, do you want it for two seasons or something? Or is it really just the, I mean, we could get a massive rainstorm in any season and
right.
any time.
Yeah.
So I think that 50% of the units may be the better benchmark.
But there wouldn't be concern that, say, the system turns out to be good enough to handle the flow from 6 buildings, but not 12. Wouldn't we have to wait until all the roofs are there to know whether the system is going to work?
Well, so you've got, so if you have, let's, these are 3 units and here's 3 units, that's 6, plus you have this existing one.
Right.
But they've got to do the loop road too. So that's, the only thing left would be the garages, and let's just say they did in that order. I mean, they may not do it in that order. But you're going to have the road runoff, and you're going to have most of the roofs. I mean, you don't have to use 50%. You can do 75.
I'm not sure that I'm thinking about it the same way you are. The amount of water comes down, and unlike my house where, you know, I've got a certain percentage coverage on a lot, they're actually having to look at runoff values. So, I mean, whether the system is operating is to handle the amount of water that comes down on that entire unit. And whether it hit a roof and ran off, it's got to manage it, whether it does that or whether it...
Whether it's clay.
So, I mean, I'm not sure that the roof issue is a big deal, because it's got to handle the volume of water that rains on that unit. I mean, on that parcel.
On the parcel of land? Mm-hmm. But it's their construction that's, the system it has to be designed to manage. Maybe I don't understand how this stuff works, but I would have thought that, sure, clay isn't very pervious, but it's more pervious than a roof.
Yes, but their entire stormwater system is going to have to be in place from the get-go.
Right. But it isn't thoroughly tested until all the structures are in place.
He is assuming that maybe there's 85% of the water that comes down might be the same, and the other 15% might not be. Once you have the roofs up there, there's going to be more impervious surface than there would have been otherwise. I think that's where he's...
I'm not arguing that roofs don't matter. I'm just saying that the performance of the system has to do it whether the roofs are in place or not, is how I'm thinking about it.
Well, the comment by the applicant made it sound like once ownership is turned over to the homeowners association, the developer is no longer
responsible.
Mm-hmm. So I don't understand if his agreement is at 50%, he's no longer owner. Then that seems like that dictates how long we can make.
Unless he's the one that put up the bond.
Right, no, the bond will carry forward. It doesn't matter how many units he still owns. If there's a timeline and there's a permit condition, you would release the bond, and only at such time that you have satisfied that system is operable.
Can I just ask, are we talking about a surety bond or a cash bond? How does the city approach that? Because that makes a big difference.
It can be. The city can't dictate which type of performance guarantee is placed. It's up to the applicant. So it can be a bond. It can be a cash escrow. It can be a letter of credit. It can be some third party, assurance. So there's a whole sort of pick list. Based on what the applicant has to choose. It doesn't have to be a bond.
So what's the language that you would typically use in this situation? A performance guarantee, is that your language?
Yeah. And it's a performance guarantee, your selection. You get to select which one it is, and there's specific language in our rules that have to be incorporated in that guarantee.
Excuse me, we have one more comment or question.
If I could just touch on that. In a practical manner, the site is comparatively small, and there is very little room to do construction after the initial start. So I would think that the first phase would have the first 2 buildings constructed. By that time, none of that could be sold before the storm management and the field would be completely operational. And then as soon as you go beyond that, you have to conclude the loop for emergency vehicles, and therefore, but from practical reasons, those foundations would probably be put in. So the coverage would be probably almost initially be complete. However, the roof lines may not be, but there may be a plywood deck or maybe a foundation, but the coverage would probably be completed almost immediately.
Mm-hmm. The entire loop.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
including
yeah,
the
I
entire
can see
loop.
That. Mm-hmm.
So again, Carolyn, explain to me how the cost and terms of said bond are set.
Well, you can write the condition so that you will sign off on the final approval before they post the bond. And they can't start construction until they post it. So all of this happens before construction. And then you can decide whether you want to see compliance and certification that it's operating according to plan at whatever threshold. So 25-50% of the build out, you know, or the units or whatever.
Yeah. And excuse me, is the amount of the bond or guarantee the equivalent equate to the cost of the installation of the stormwater management infrastructure based on a development budget?
That's right. And plus 20% contingency.
I think as far as the time, it has to be, if not when all the structures are built, at least when the foundations are in for all the structures, as was just said, that would be sufficient. But I think if only six of the building, if there are only six structures there, we don't even know yet whether the system works. So it should
be. That would not be a problem. I've just confirmed that all of those foundations are going to go in at the front end.
Okay.
So I'll let you all mull on that a little bit. I made notes to myself as I was going through the project, and I'd like to sort of air the other side of what I was thinking while I was going through it. I do think they've, by threefold, they've exceeded the open space requirements mm-hmm. that they were after. I like the fact that they're keeping the existing house. I like the fact that they match the streetscape so that it doesn't look like a straggly tooth on that street now. So the building is coming as expected off the street. I hope tonight we'll discuss the tree ordinance. Their proposal would be in line with what we have intended to put in place there with replacements and keeping them. Appreciate the lot sizes. There is an expense to putting in a circular driveway for a developer, and I like the fact that that's been worked in for the traffic control there and the use of that as a mechanism to filter the drain water that goes into that center area. I like the architecture. It's a New England style architecture. It's not a inappropriate looking kind of building set to put in that area. I thought the traffic considerations were well met. I had done some work on that. I like the fact that it utilizes the bike path, that it's got covered bike parking, that it's got a recycling center. And I appreciate the fact that it's got a HERS rating that's 25% better as far as the energy usage on these small units. I see a town of very large Victorians that many people would like to live in those smaller units. And so those were my thoughts on the pros of the project. And I think I could summarize the conditions, and I'd ask anyone else to comment before we go there.
I think there was a comment from, I think it came from DPW, but suggested that maple trees planted along the street should be set back so they don't interfere with the overhead utilities.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then just to make sure you include in the condition that is offered the traffic mitigation be made prior to final certificate of occupancy, but I would suggest you could have it after the sixth unit. And it's a one-time payment to address the incremental impacts of the additional units on the system.
Okay. Do you have draft words for the performance guarantee?
Yeah, I mean, so I suggested prior to construction of the project, the applicant must post a performance guarantee in accordance with the planning board rules that will cover the cost for the stormwater system. Prior to posting the bond, the final amount shall be approved by the planning board. The board may only release the amount upon the applicant showing that the system is functioning as designed, but not prior to completion of all the foundations. I don't know if that covers generally what you
said. I
think so.
And that means that we're going to be relying on the reports that have to be filed already, correct? So we're going to, I mean, we're not asking for additional reports separate and apart.
Yeah,
from
that's a good point. How do we know that it works? Don't
well,
we
I mean,
get a certification.
Although they already need to supply a report.
Well, this is before the report, so there's a certificate.
Okay.
So there would be an as-built. Showing, and maybe you, I mean, you could add that language in the final condition that can be released upon, I mean, it's more than the as-built, you want to see that it's functioning, so they need to show the as-built anyway,
yeah.
But from what I'm gathering, you want to make sure that the as-built also
works,
that the design
yeah,
works.
Yes.
The
design works mm-hmm. in reality.
So wouldn't it have to be certified by an independent engineer or person of some sort? I mean, we don't know.
Right, right. So you'd get the engineer to certify, do the as-built, and then do a report, you know, at the time that the units are in. So it's after the units are in.
So we ask the city engineer for a report.
No, it's not the city engineer, it's
okay.
The applicant's engineer.
Okay.
They submit it to us, we look at it, the city engineer evaluates it.
Okay.
But the city's
yeah, but
not.
Not an as-built report after all the foundations are constructed.
A performance right. guarantee after the foundations.
Well, a report from applicant engineer that the system works to not increase stormwater flows. Right.
Or per design, but it works per design, because we're approving that the design has been approved.
Right. It's functioning as designed, but not prior to completion. So that evaluation can't be done prior to completion of all the
right.
foundations.
Okay, so I'm going to review the condition.
We do still have public comment open. Is it specific?
Yes.
My name is Karen Beerward. I live at 99 Montauk Street in Florence. However, I grew up at 92 Barrett Street, across the street from the project. I just have a question on the timing of checking whether this drainage system works. What I'm hearing is that you'd wait until all the foundations are in, but one thing I heard earlier was part of the drainage system included the roofs, and water was coming specifically off the roof through pipes into the drainage system. And if the foundations are just there without this roof system, you're not, that part of the drainage system is not being tested or considered. So I just, that part is omitted, and I just think that should be something that
thank you
should be considered.
So we're talking about having the front buildings built, the concrete pads in the back done, and the system in place. And so how much, what is the amount of that water that's not going down into a drainage pipe?
Well, you'd still have the runoff from the, you're
right.
still
yeah,
going to have
right.
the block there.
Right.
It's not being
in fact, it's
collected.
Not, it's not allowed to, it's not
Right, so that it has to be managed at that point, whether or not it's directly tied, the water's still going to be coming off of an impervious.
Seems it would.
Either that or it's filling up the foundation.
It's not basements, it's just a, it's just a slab. A slab is like, you know, that's interesting, because I had the basement concept in mind. Yeah, it's just slab, which is like a roof.
Right.
Are they built on a slab?
Only the first building is built on a slab, because we weren't able to drain the footing drain, so there was no ability to put a full cellar. The other buildings will have full cellars. So the degree that the system would have to occupy.
See, that's
if
different.
If there's no more water going on off-site, it would have to handle everything. If the foundations are in, it's taken care of.
Does that mean
it's
that
covered.
Does that mean it'll just fill up the basement?
If you didn't take care of it, yes. But of course we will take care of it. The opportunity to take care of it is by building the first deck, the first floor to cover up the foundation. To that degree, you've covered it, whether it's the concrete slab or the deck above.
So I guess we should say foundation and and deck.
Well.
Although I guess there would
be
anyway.
Yeah, you don't need to do that.
Have a swimming pool and every.
But let me clarify what the concern was voiced there, that if the water coming off the concrete slab is not going into the drainage system the way it's designed, in other words, it's not going in the gutter drainage system down, then that proportion of water is just going into the clay around the lot. And so is that a valid test of the stormwater management system, because there's some margin of water that's not actually going to the system? And my thoughts on it are that when I look at 2.1 acres and I've built out the driveway and I've built out the house in front and I've got the existing house and I'm probably working on this one and I've got these concrete slabs, I'm not sure that we're talking about very much margin. But it's also an issue that I think would be settled by the DPW engineer. I don't know that that's mine to do.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to have to grade out the site according to the way it was designed for the swales and everything. So it's impervious cover. You're introducing impervious cover. So it's as good as a roof, if not better, because you're not necessarily directing it the way you want to direct it.
That's
the
a
end.
Good point. Yeah. So, in other words, it would, once you get everything built, at best it'd have an opportunity to behave better because it's using the system as designed.
Right.
So we could go back to as soon as all the foundations are in.
Right. Okay. So I think that one condition is the one that we really need to hear and think about the language, and then I can read the rest of them.
Okay. Can we read again?
Yep.
Prior to construction of the project, the applicant must post a performance guarantee in accordance with the planning board rules that will cover the cost of the stormwater system. Prior to posting the guarantee, the final amount shall be approved by the planning board. The bond may only be released upon review and approval of the report from the applicant. From the applicant's engineer that the system is working according to design, or is functioning according to design, and this evaluation must be done after completion of all foundations.
Okay, I'm going to read for you to track the other conditions that I've got, and then when we actually make the proposal, we'll say with conditions as determined. Mm-hmm. So we want electric service to the neighbors without cost to them if changes are made. We want shielded lighting to the neighbors, but not the street. We want east edge planting from the existing arborvitae hedge towards the front of the lot to the edge of the structure. We want to allow no lower curb, that we're granting that one. And the maples on the street will be set back, and the traffic mitigation will be made prior to certificate of occupancy for the sixth unit. Okay. Someone got their agenda, can make a motion for me? Oh, I'm sorry, yes. So, do I hear a motion to close public hearing? Tess, seconded by John. All in favor? Any more board discussion to be had?
We issue the permit with all the conditions that have been read.
Alan makes a motion?
Yeah.
Do I have a second? Dan's a second. All in favor? So granted. On the agenda, we have a amendment to the zoning codes for rural residential districts. And I have a proposal for us along that line.
We also have a, we have a tree before that, the continuation of the tree ordinance.
Oh, I'm sorry, I missed that one.
But it doesn't, I mean, we're past both of those, so if you want to do the other ones first, I just wanted to make sure.
Welcome back, Mark and Bill. So yeah, we'll do them in order. I'm sorry, I now like to open the agenda item for the continuation of a public hearing on amendment to 2.1 and 12.3 tree ordinance discussion.
We are in the midst of a Patriots game.
So you guys wanted some more time to look at that ordinance, and in the interim, a couple of comments came in that I forwarded along to you. Well, I guess a whole set of comments from the Tree Commission, now I see what they're called. And then prior to that, National Grid called, and they had some concerns that they didn't want to be swooped into this because they want to be able to maintain their rights of way better. So I just want to make sure those two things get on the in the mix to discuss.
Carolyn, I guess the question I had from last time, or the concern I had was, and you know, I've read this now again, I'm still not sure, but is the ability. Does the ordinance in any way impinge upon someone's ability to manage their own property, I guess? Is that?
So the intent, so all, as this was being drafted, there was a lot of discussion about at what threshold does this, would this kick in? So the idea that it really only kicks in if you are doing a project that would trigger a site plan or special permit or other, some other permit by the zoning board. Means that if you as an individual property owner are just managing your property, maybe you're clearing because you've got dead trees or what have you, that's not going to trigger site plan. So this doesn't affect what you do on your property if there's no other
if you just want to cut down a tree.
Right.
So
if you want, and it doesn't affect, sorry, it doesn't affect someone who wants to do an addition. Let's say they want to do a master bedroom or whatever and push the footprint out and there's a huge oak tree there. Expansion of a single family home doesn't trigger site plan. Therefore, someone who wants to put on that master bedroom addition could cut away.
What about in this example, that property is full of big trees?
Mm-hmm. So there were two trees that were over, well, the other issue is about there's some inconsistency between the zoning, proposed zoning language and what we have in subdivision regs. And in subdivision regs, we have a threshold of 20-inch diameter breast height for trees to be included on plans. So let's say we went with the 20-inch instead of what's on the in front of you in the zoning for 24. There were two trees on this plan that were over 20 inches that they were proposing to cut. So by doing that calculation, I figured that there would be 14
trees that they would have to plant of at least 2.5-inch caliper.
But what if it was forested?
If it was work?
I mean, that seems really burdensome. Oh, and it seems like a ridiculous amount of trees to plant.
What if, go back to the first first issue we looked at today, a special permit, PV array. They didn't have to take down any trees, but what if they had a lot of acreage and there was one giant tree in the middle of that yard, and that's where they wanted to put the PV array? Weren't hurting anybody. They own the property. It's their own thing. But in order for the PV array to go up, the trees got to come down. So we could say, it's your yard, it's your private space, but you can't do that.
No, the formula is then you replace the tree. So if you took down a big tree that then by formula, let's say you need to replace it with six smaller trees planted somewhere, you cut down that tree and you replant elsewhere on the property.
But that may not make sense for a lot of people. I wouldn't think that.
Right, so then
Or isn't the other option to pay?
The other option is to pay so that they get, those trees get planted within the city right-of-way, presumably within the vicinity of the subject parcel. But that way, you know, you're sort of trading a large specimen tree for other trees that are distributed elsewhere so that that canopy can grow up again.
But going back to Mark's example, you want to put in a solar array, you have to cut down a tree, you have to replace that tree with little trees on your property that you maintain. That's not affecting it. I don't know. It's still still something there that makes it seem like we're putting, like as Bill said, that it's burdensome on the individual when it only is on their property.
So the other thing about so if you notice as we were making some of these changes, and you'll see in this when the next discussion for RR and SR that we started out with. Special permit and site plan required for certain amount of individual single-family home PV installation, ground-mounted. And we slowly then allowing those either by right or with lower, less review. So we're actually getting to a point where this person here who came tonight wouldn't have to come potentially in the future.
Was this triggered by the size of the...
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, that's what I thought. Mm-hmm.
So I tried that argument about the restricting use of your personal property out on one of the tree committee people who had, you know, who obviously have a vested interest in this. And their reaction is we really need this for the, not to take an approach to the individual that's going to be the exception, but to the developer who we want to do right by it. And I went and looked at the Day Street lot that we recently did that has three units going in on it, and there are some large trees coming down out of that. They're down. They're gone. Now, that the plan for that does call for replanting, so I think that project would have been okay too, but it puts us in a position to guarantee that replanting, which it would not have been if we didn't have that for that project. And just last, the other comment from the tree committee member was, there are many restrictions that we tolerate on our own property. I mean, there are many things you can't do with your property. So just by virtue of being your property doesn't entirely put in a different consideration. But that's just to add what I have kind of run into in talking to people about this around town.
Though and I guess the other side of that, to me, would be, you know, I mean, and you know, I'm married to a biologist who works in conservation. I love trees, so that's not the issue. But the other side of it is, you know, by having the kinds of things just like this project, we just, you know, encouraging infill is a really good environmental thing to do. So I feel like it's there's that side of it. But let's recognize what also we're trying to do by encouraging these kinds of things, which are protecting trees that aren't on somebody's lot already in an urban setting. They're out in the suburbs that don't exist because we're doing infill.
Right.
So I mean, there's that part of it too, that, you know, by having those kinds of policies and allowing people to do things in, you know, in the urban environment, we're protecting trees that aren't being cut down because we're doing it here, and maybe the tree's already in an urban environment, so therefore we're not cutting down a forest. We're, you know, we're maybe cutting trees, but it's, you know, it's already in an urban environment.
I kind of see that, but at the same time, I think the infill development is a policy. We're not going out and strong-arming developers into actually doing infill development, whereas somebody physically cutting an asset down that produces benefit for the wider community, we know, in terms of climate and air temperature and such. I think those are just different things from, you know, between a policy and actually going and cutting down a tree that ought to be replaced somewhere, whether it's on their property or they pay the fee and it goes into, you know, street trees. That seems very different to me. It seems like we're just saying this is an asset on your property, it provides you benefit, it provides the community benefit. We've got to maintain it somewhere.
But the other thing is, we're talking about significantly large trees.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
20, depending on whatever number we decide on, let's say it's 20 inch, you know, that's at DBH. So it's
20 inch diameter?
Yeah. So,
so that's
radius.
Something like that.
Mm-hmm. Right, but it's at.
Right.
It's this high off the ground. Right. So, it's not at the very base.
Right.
So you know, the pine tree that was up discussed mm-hmm. here at this point, somewhere around here, that's 18 labeled on the plan. So that wouldn't be considered under this ordinance. I mean, I don't know if anybody went to the site. It looks big when you're out there, mm-hmm. but that doesn't count. So they're probably, you know, these are going to be unique trees. And if someone's going to be putting a PV array in their yard, maybe they would think before they say, okay, this is the easiest place for me, I'm just going to cut this tree. Maybe they'll say, I'm going to have to plant 6 other trees. Maybe I can think of a different place on my property that doesn't, you know, that isn't affected by that. I mean, maybe they wouldn't be able to.
But they wouldn't have to do that unless the PV array is of a certain size that triggers.
Right.
So in theory, if I have a 24-inch tree in the middle of my yard, and I've got a dog, and I want to have Fido run around, I can cut the tree down. Mm-hmm. But if I want to build a PV array of a certain size that triggers a special permit, then the requirement kicks in.
Right.
That makes me plant 6 other trees.
Right.
So cut first.
File the permit.
No, but that's the other part of this language is you have 8. So it's backdated 18 months. So if you're, you know, because we know that it takes a long time for those plans to germinate in your head.
So I think when we started discussing this, there was a level of unease about telling a private property owner what you can and can't do with your tree. And I think the consolation was if there's a trigger, if there's a need for a special permit or a site plan review, then that would give us just cause to add our 2 cents onto whether or not they could or should do that. And if they choose to do it, then the consequence is, you know, you have to add more trees. And so I think ultimately I'm okay if no permits are needed, have at it, do what you want, it's your property, we're not going to say anything. But if they have to come in front of the board and ask permission to do something, then in response we can say, well, if you're going to cut that tree down, you have to.
Or not. I mean, I think
right. It
is a case-by-case basis.
Right.
And I think what Carolyn's trying to say is that those are the special cases. The individuals coming before us are the unusual, not the norm that we're trying to actually control. And that in some ways we're moving in a direction so that there will be fewer of those in the future anyway.
Mm-hmm. And you look, it's not cutting down trees, but planting trees. You look at what's happened along King Street over the last 15 years, where the number of trees and the sequencing of trees and the tree belt along the street, what it looks like now versus, and what we're trying to get towards over a certain amount of time, it looks so much better than it did, you know, 20 years ago. And that's because we require a certain number of trees and so forth. So, you know, to the point of this development, this is exactly why we would want something like that to encourage.
Yeah, I feel like we're lucky. This one and the one before it both have met this requirement.
Right.
But I don't think we, that's why I think we need this requirement, because I'm happy that they did.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, just the one area where I'm still having a little trouble, and maybe the size of the tree takes care of it, but, you know, there's been developments up off Burt's Pit Road and whatnot, and, you know, those have been all woodlands, and you got to put a road in, and you got to put houses in, and people want backyards, and, you know, you cut down a lot of trees, and then, you know, you leave certain ones strategically, or you plant ones in the front yard and whatnot. But if they've got to cut down a lot of those trees for the roads and the backyards and the foundations, and then they're required to put six more trees in an, you know, up in an already well-treed neighborhood, just seems, you know, a little ridiculous, you
well,
know, or to go, you know, pay kind of this.
Right, I don't have to plant.
Fine,
and we do traffic mitigation. I don't see it that different than we than a lot of the other things we do. Traffic mitigation, they can either pay or make improvements. So, and I don't think, because they're significant trees, I don't think that you're going to find any piece of property that's going to have a great number of
I mean, maybe that covers it. I guess
it's a pretty good size tree.
I'd almost make the argument that a lot of the sort of grown up smaller trees, the lots that are highly treed are not necessarily treed with these kind of trees.
Right,
they're the
you
know, they're the little
so that
next generation.
That.
But I still think we could deal with it on a case by case. I'd feel better if we had something in place that solved the problem that we don't want to have happen. You know, the development that we can't ask for
right, and it's and it's special permit, so it just gives us the opportunity to weigh in. It doesn't so
are there any language changes? I think I'm willing to go for a vote and just see where we are on it, but I'd like to know, is there any I'd like it much better if it said so and so. There is the issue that Carolyn brought up about being consistent with something else,
the subdivision rules.
Subdivision rules. So
and the one's 20 and one's, this one's 24.
This one's 24.
Right. So subdivision says if you're planning a subdivision, we want to see all your 20-inch DBH trees before you make any cuts and save them to the extent that you can.
Something like that.
But it's 20 inches the threshold as opposed to 24. So it was the tree commission that sort of pointed out that we should try to be consistent and not have two different standards. Which we're fine. I mean, I'm fine with, obviously, it brings the number down. Mm-hmm. And it's not that we can't go back and change subdivision if you think 24 is better. I will, I mean, it's just on my screen. I don't have it up there, but I did pull up the Emerson Way project, mm-hmm. and I'm just looking on Google Earth, and there are a lot of skinny, tall trees in there.
Right.
So I think a lot of them wouldn't have even been near hitting that threshold. Just as an example, I know that's just one piece, but just to sort of put it in context a little bit, I think, you know, these are really
big trees. You're saying, Devin, these are second generation trees that we're talking
about. I was reading something about Lori Sanders' report, and she was talking about it was Mineral Hills, mm-hmm. and that has been completely logged at the end of the 1800s,
right.
and now it's all grown back up, but it's grown back up that way because we just don't have old growth.
Right.
So I think we should be consistent with the diameter, and to me a 20-inch tree 4 feet off the ground, that's still a big tree, and so 24.
Not that I'm wanting wiggle room, but it's still a case by case, it's a special permit.
Right.
So do you want me to run through these comments at all from the tree committee, or?
I just want one clarification. In lieu of the six trees, how much money are we talking about?
Let me just look at the language.
I don't think it's got a dollar amount.
Mm. Yeah, it doesn't.
I think
it's to be determined by the city, I think.
Yeah, enough to plant new public shade trees on city property.
Right.
And so it would depend on, the other thing is obviously costs change over time, so I think if there were a dollar amount or set amount, then you'd have to go back and amend the ordinance to do that.
Well, I just think it'd be nice to have an idea of what that would cost, or...
Well, though a developer would know, based on the formula, how many trees they'd have to plant of a certain caliper, and then they can, that information, that cost would be readily available based on the caliper, not on the cost of the tree.
Yeah, I mean, there was a comment from the tree commission member, or maybe it's the committee voted together to make these comments. The formula should be an exact formula based on dollars per DBH, and the tree warden should be given blah, 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 blah. This is a lot of detail that shouldn't be in the zoning. Right. I think it just, a lot of those comments, I think, would fall into that category that it doesn't belong in a regulation. Right. So I think, we do that again. So if someone's coming before you and you're saying, and they're asking not to plant the trees, it could be determined at that time as well. So, you could ask the applicant, what's the cost of a 2.5-inch maple or whatever, and find that out and make that determination at the time of a permit. So that it goes with the times.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. And a 2.5-inch maple doesn't cost the same as a 2.5-inch elm or a 2.5-inch. And so it would depend on the type of tree and time, now or 5 years from now that they ask to do the work. So
right.
I think the formula should be consistent, and the dollar value shouldn't even be
right.
mentioned.
Right.
Yeah.
And one other comment that I received from the tree committee is that the city itself, if you did the like-kind replacement and you said, here, the city takes that money, the city might be interested in planting smaller trees because they take so much better.
Right.
That way they would get more trees out of it right. in public way where they would be kept. So Carolyn, you just mentioned, you put in the comments from the committee, but then you said that you didn't think those belonged in there?
No, I forwarded the comments the committee sent to you.
Right.
So some of them are just questions. And so I thought, I would not recommend adopting their recommendations wholesale. I mean, I think they're going to give their comments back to City Council, but I think City Council is going to ask you all what your opinion is. So I think it would make sense to say, page one, all definitions should be consistent with ANSI standard, blah, blah, blah. I think, okay, that's fine. We can do that. And then the consistency with subdivision rules, you guys just talked about that 20-inch, fine. And then there's a question about significant tree is only defined as a deciduous tree. So they're claiming they want all the trees to be considered. So that's a question for you. Do you agree with that, or do you think deciduous? I mean,
we have an approved tree list. Why wouldn't it be those trees?
Well, because those are deciduous trees. So I think they're coming from an angle of they want all trees. I think
they
want to
protect. They want to protect. We want to plant one kind, but they want to protect all kinds.
Right. Right. Right.
Not quite the same thing.
Right. So, it may be a personal opinion, but white pine can grow really tall and then cause problems.
Yep.
So I'm not sure that, we want to be protecting white pines that are 20-inch DBH that could be right next to somebody's.
Well, I mean, there is a provision, any deciduous tree 24 inches DBH or any other tree specifically identified as a specimen tree. So could they say, here's the non-deciduous trees that ought to be protected or ought to be on this no-kill list?
Well, right, so it's, right, so any other idea.
I mean, can't they, it seems to be like there's a mechanism for the tree committee to say, they mentioned spruce, fir, hemlock. I'm going to say I couldn't recognize any of these trees from one another, but if white pine, can be problematic, then it doesn't go on the list, right?
Well, I think, but this is also saying the city should identify those other types of trees if we feel like they're significant. Maybe we'll go out and we'll find this 40-inch you know, spruce or fir tree, and then it'll get tagged, and we'll say, okay, all deciduous trees plus this one particular 40
right,
inch.
Right. Can we ask the tree committee to do that, though? I mean,
well, I think if you leave this, if this language stays in there, it's sort of putting the onus on some tree inventory to be taken,
right,
in order to be included. So it doesn't say tree committee has to do it, but it says, hey, if you're really interested.
Right. I mean, we could ask them to do it, right?
Yeah.
If they're really interested.
Yeah. So does it sound like leave that those two comments off?
What's the downside in just saying all trees? Not deciduous or non-deciduous?
The white pine example is a softwood tree. And so, you know, it twists right out when it gets older. And so,
So if a 24-inch white pine was hanging over my bedroom roof, I'd take it down.
You would.
Yeah. So
yeah, but that's allowed anyway.
Yeah, that'd be allowed.
But and also we're allowed to take out trees that are dead
or dying.
I mean, mm-hmm. that's allowed in mm-hmm. here. So these are healthy trees we're talking about.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't see a problem with any type of healthy white pine.
Yeah, we're trying to prevent the removal of healthy bay trees.
Okay, so no one wants to discriminate?
To kill them.
No discrimination.
No discrimination.
All trees. All trees matter.
We're so liberal.
Yes.
No. All right, we better move on. All right, we're not going to define tree inventory plan. I think that's self-explanatory. That would be my recommendation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think that's for the committee.
I don't think certified arborist needs to be defined. And maintenance and tree protection plan, I think, is self-explanatory. And we have a definition of non-invasive on our website, so I just would recommend referencing the NorthamptonMA.gov, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So then there's a section, the term remove should be defined to include death by negligence.
Nope.
During construction.
During construction.
So I think that the issue here is, I mean, you could do that, but also you're reviewing a site plan and you're also reviewing the tree protection plan.
Right.
And you're going to want to see that that protection plan mm-hmm. is mm-hmm. good enough.
Mm-hmm.
And they're probably get a certified arborist to say, here's what you need to do. And you've done that already right. on other projects that aren't for significant trees.
Right.
So this sort of adds another level of sort of penalty. So it's, I don't know what you think about that.
What's the comment again?
They want to add a term that to remove a tree also includes death by negligence.
During construction.
So if you keep driving the backhoe back and forth right next to the trunk.
Well, it doesn't have to be right next to it. I actually like that comment. I think that's, that we could have not had the discussion tonight and that evergreen wouldn't have made it.
And they usually don't die, though, during construction. They might die 2 years later is one of the problems.
Or five, like I'm
talking. Right, and then they might have died of something else. So it's really hard to know. I mean, it could be really hard to know.
If they wanted to keep that tree, there'd be a tree protection plan
that would
be over for our review. If they didn't, so if it stayed, we'd see how they're gonna keep it.
Sure.
So they can't neglect it. If. So I don't know, it seems redundant to me, like not needed, because we already covered it. You know
I agree,
mean?
Yeah. It's already covered in the tree protection.
Then it says this should be clear that it includes subdivision plans as well. I think it's clear, but we could add subdivision just to put suspenders on it and a belt. Okay, D, the Public Shade Tree Commission looks forward to, I think that shouldn't be in an ordinance.
Right.
No.
I think this is what we're doing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It's like they're passing us a note.
Yeah.
Yeah. So tree, I think the last, under four, and agreed to in writing by the tree warden, I think that's how, I mean, at a staff level, we would defer anyway.
Does he have to give you a written report, or can he just say, I reviewed it and I agree?
Well, that's the thing, it says in writing, so I think now, I call DPW, I call Rich Persoletti, who's the arborist, and say, what do you think about this plan? And he might tell me verbally, or he might tell me in writing. Well, I might ask him for writing.
So that's what I'm saying, I don't know that in writing is, I mean, they're trying to make sure that he gets the review, but if
I think that might be onerous.
I'd rather say, and reviewed by the tree warden, and then you can get a yes, and that's all you need.
Right.
So the property owner is going to have to absorb the expense of the certified arborist.
Right.
Yeah, which we just saw.
One or the other.
Right.
Because the arborist, I don't know, are we worried that the arborist is his neighbor or his friend or something?
I think that's what the review takes care of, but I don't think the city would want to give that expertise to the builder for free.
Kind of like Berkshire Design going on DPW.
Right.
We just did this with Leah Honda. They hired their arborist. They came in. They told us what would have to be done, and we said that, you know.
Yeah.
There's certified agreed to by the tree warden. I don't know why. Yeah, I'd eliminate in writing if that's going to be some burden. Okay. That's fine.
So we already talked about that. Non-invasive is defined. Okay, get rid of in writing again by the tree warden. I don't. You know, I don't have any preference as to whether we add language that the replacement trees shall conform to the latest standards for nursery stock, but that also, you know, we have a tree list and we say what can be planted. I think that might be further burdening someone to go get a, you know, go to a nursery that has been, you know, that's established in accordance with these standards. So,
well, I've got a problem in that if we're trying to create a replacement plan and then it doesn't work, then we just go back and do the replacement plan. I mean, I think that we wouldn't set something different.
Yeah. Right. Okay. And then this next section, I don't.
Section.
CFI. They're claiming we need to update some section where we allow green ash. That's the first I heard of it. So I think that's just a comment to us. So it doesn't go in
right,
the ordinance.
That's,
I like Tess's note comment. So they're passing us a note.
And then the fund issue we already talked about, that doesn't need to be addressed. Mm-hmm. And then down below in F, we could say should follow, you know, ANSI A300 standards, that's fine. Certified arborist shall submit a letter in writing. So that's the documentation. I don't think we need to define what writing is. And then I would suggest not incorporating the last suggestion. Tree warden should be granted authority to sign off on a protection plan. I think that's already wrapped in this. Mm-hmm. And then I think trees should be preserved and placed in updates annually into the city street inventory database. I mean, I think record keeping is enough. I think we don't even have a database yet. So.
Right.
Was this related to my comment about geolocating? But the GIS layer?
It could be. No, because they wouldn't have heard that.
Oh.
But I mean, I think the goal, like, they want to do this,
so
that's fine. They're going to do it, but it doesn't need to be part of the ordinance.
Yeah. Right.
No. And in G, we've got something about record keeping and the tree inventory database.
Yeah. So.
What do you want from us, Carolyn?
Okay. So there's that, and then what did you have a chance to think about the National Grid's comments?
Oh, right.
So this section. So they would like to add, just in the top paragraph, this section is not meant to regulate work performed by a utility company in maintenance of its rights of way or in its maintenance, repair, or replacement of infrastructure that's unrelated to a development project requiring zoning relief. I'm fine with that. I don't think it's necessary, but.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Of course they're going to ask that, is my first reaction.
Yeah. But how many super big trees do they have in their rights of way anyway?
Yeah, that's right. The same.
We got rid of those a long time ago.
That's right.
I'll take that.
Or they're already 5 feet tall.
Okay.
So are we making a motion to recommend that this revised ordinance be sent to City Council?
Do I hear a second?
Second. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah. Tess makes the motion and Ann seconds it, that this as revised ordinance be recommended to City Council.
Okay. Okay.
How bad do you need?
Bad. It won't take long, will it?
So moved.
Okay. Well, one thing we can do.
I mean, you could actually, I'll take that back. I just wasn't paying attention and found out the ordinance committee can actually have its public hearing on Monday because it's Rosh Hashanah and I didn't check the calendar. So what that means is ordinance committee can't hear, they want us to hear it after you. They can't hear it this month, so they're going to be punted till October. So if you want to wait till September 24th, that's okay with me.
I'm doing sure.
What's on the agenda for the 24th?
Because we don't have a big public crowd for this hearing. So you did get the continuation for Village Hill, was just September 24th. They are not going to be ready for September 24th. They're going to ask for one more continuation to October. So otherwise, we really don't have a bunch of stuff for the 24th. So it's fine with me if you want to.
Yeah, let's do that.
Or are we still meeting on the 24th?
Well, you have to meet to continue that hearing anyway.
So. Okay.
And I'll have to see if there's, I feel like there was something else too, but you know, it'll be a short meeting because of that. I think there is some kind of it.
Okay, somebody approved the minutes because I read them,
are
they look good.
Are you continuing this to?
Motion to continue to September 24th.
For the, thank you, for the residential rule,
yes.
And the.
And well, who is the second?
Dan. Thanks, Mark.
Residential.
Yep. Yeah, suburban residential.
Okay. So, do you want to do, let me see what time that was continued.
Well, I think we should do it early.
Right, I just want to see what, I think we continued the other one to 7:30, so we could do this one at 7:30 also, because okay. It's going to be, let me just double check, though, if you just give me 2 seconds.
This is just kind of coming from the planning department, he's recommending, not coming from me.
7:30, yeah. So, well, I can explain that. Let me just, so 7:30, is that okay? 7:30.
The meeting?
Okay, yeah.
For the
continuation.
The agenda item.
Oh, just the item,
yeah.
Not the, okay, all right. Not talking about starting.
Oh. Wait, hold on. We might want to do, okay, we'll do 7:30. So, yes, it came from our office, but we were triggered to do it because of the PV, ground-mounted PV arrays, and I can explain that during the public hearing. So we would have gotten around to it eventually, but we just bumped it up to the top of the list because there was a request by a property owner that we address a specific thing that's in RR and SR. So we just said, fine, let's just do the whole, let's just, instead of just addressing that one minor zoning change, let's just go ahead and reformat the whole.
Because there were issues
table.
Associated with these other things?
Yeah.
Got it.
All right, we can go over that then.
Okay, so we've gotten that continued.
Yeah.
Taskmaster wants an approval of the minutes.
Motion to approve the minutes.
Hold on the minutes, apparently I didn't have, make much of an impact, but I was at that meeting.
Oh, yeah.
I would ask that.
Does it say in there that you were asked?
It says he was not there.
Recusing?
Yeah, it said something about recusing.
You recused later, but in the table.
Oh, you're not marked.
Not checked on the table.
You must have been late. Okay, I'll change that.
All in favor of the minutes as corrected? Aye. Thank you. Motion to adjourn?
Oh, wait, just one other thing. Just so you know, you had an A&R item on there, it wasn't ready, so I'm not ready to present it to you.
Where's our recycling?
Yeah. City council.
Motion to adjourn by Dan, seconded by Tess.
I don't know, somebody took the pin out.
All in favor?
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you, Dan.
There might be one out in the hall.